Now, Jandre, today you shaved off a piece of equipment that was underneath your nose.
Yes. Yes. Absolutely.
Jandre had to shave off his moustache, which he grew for the purposes of Movember. Now, Movember, of course, is a very important part of, the awareness for prostate cancer. And that is what Jandre was growing his Movember for. Thank you, Jandre, for taking the time to do that.
Yes.
Now, it is, of course, extremely important. And I am very distressed, Jandre, that you did not take the time to show us your moustache.
Yeah.
Yes. Jandre's moustache, everybody, went like that.
Beautiful.
It wasn't, I wouldn't have described it as bushy, would you?
No.
No. Elegant, really. That's very, very strong term, elegant. But yes, I suppose you might want to use that term.
Romantic.
Well, Jandre, yes. Not any real wonder, of course, that you're living here as a bachelor. Now, we're going to try and find Karula this afternoon. Of course, she absconded with her Impala sometime this morning into a jackalberry tree somewhere around here. There is a squirrel shouting, Jandre. In fact, there are tracks heading this way. Shall we follow them and see where they go? There is a jackalberry tree in somewhere. Oh dear, the tracks do a little circle. Look, let me show you what the tracks do. This has been a fascinating, fascinating trip. Excellent, very nice. Super, on we go. Yes. Now, of course, this is the pre-show to the show, which is the real show of the show. And what we're supposed to do now is tell you that you must subscribe to know when we're going to be live by clicking on the bell to the bottom right-hand side of your screen. You know, of course, that you are in the pre-show of the show because I'm wearing sunglasses. I would, of course, not be using sunglasses were I talking to you not on the pre-show of the show. Jandre, you thought that's very funny, didn't you?
Yeah,
mm-hmm. I'm going to leave your face on a Sisyphus mucronata bush later on today. Do you think this is the tree? It doesn't look like a jackalberry to me. In fact, the tracks don't go this way. No, Brent came along here. Yeah, but Brent came along this way earlier today. Maybe it's along here. We'll have a brief look. There's a jackalberry there. La, la, la. La, 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 la. I am warming up my voice. I am warming up my voice. My voice is warming up. That is not a jackalberry tree, it is a large tumbo tie. Now I will turn around and continue the other way. Right, goodbye everybody. When you see me next, I shall be serious. Goodbye. Off with you. Off. Away.
This program features live coverage of an African safari and may include animal kills and carcasses. Viewer discretion is advised.
It's a beautiful, beautiful, clear day. Clear skies, really hot in the African bush. And welcome, this is Safari Live.
Ready?
Go!
by.
And welcome to Safari Live. My name is Byron, and on camera with me this afternoon is Brian, the B&B team back together again, and the Thumb. Good afternoon, Thumb. And on the other vehicle, we've got James and Jandre, and then on Bushwalk this afternoon, Jamie and VM. So full house. Hopefully we're going to be finding lots of animals and lots of interesting little creatures to look at. We also have Jerry and Rebecca in the FC as always. Now I hope you're all having a great day and a great start to the weekend. It's a very, very warm day, about 31 degrees Celsius or about 86 degrees Fahrenheit, somewhere around there. Very hot. It actually feels a lot warmer than that, I must be honest. So our plan for this afternoon is we're going to be driving around and checking waterholes, just like this one off to my left. And we're going to see if we can potentially find any animals going down to drink. There's nothing here at the moment. But we've just got started, so we will see and try our best. Hopefully we find some elephant. I've been looking for a nice herd of elephant for the last few days, last few weeks, 2 weeks or so. They've just been moving around a lot more because there's a lot of food and vegetation and water all over because of all the rain that we've had. So they haven't needed to be in one specific area. They've been kind of just moving and... dispersing over the area. Word of the day, Brian. I think I might do a word of the day every day. we'll think of something every day, and we'll see what everyone thinks. Please don't forget, everyone, send us your questions and your comments. We are live, so everything you send we get immediately, maybe a few second delay, and then we're able to answer them for you. You can send them via Twitter at #SafariLive. Otherwise, email us questions@wildearth.tv. And all of us will try and answer your questions and see what we can all learn together on our safari. And we had an exciting morning. There were lions around. We managed to find the Nkuhuma pride. The whole pride was together. All the females, 5 females and the 6 cubs. They're all looking fit and healthy, which is great. And then Brent and James managed to find Karula, the beautiful female leopard that is basically the... I'd say the, not quite the alpha female, there isn't a thing like that with leopards, but she's the most dominant leopard in this area, female leopard in this area. That we tend to see her fairly regularly, and her cubs. They had a kill in a tree not far from camp, in those beautiful clearings outside of camp. But I think she's taken the kill down into the drainage line, possibly a bit too busy. But I'm sure James and Jamie will try and find her this afternoon. And speaking of Jamie, let's cross over to her now on a bushwalk.
And a very good afternoon to all of you, and welcome on the walk portion of this sunset safari. My name is Jamie, and this afternoon I have VM on camera with me, and Aubrey heading out in front of us, keeping an eye on what's happening around us, and of course acting as spotter extraordinaire. Oh, being on foot, of course, is one of the best ways to experience life out here and wildlife out here. It does sometimes help if you remember where sightings are, because this morning on our way home, we'd heard the search for Karula and the fact that there was an impala kill in a tree on quarantine, and we didn't quite realize exactly what side of quarantine she was on. So as we walked home, James had just finished off for the morning, and we were quite far away, so we had quite a long way to walk home. And Eggsy and myself and Aubrey were wandering along. All of a sudden, Aubrey looks down, and there's the drag mark from the Impala. And I looked up, and I don't know, about 70-odd meters away, there was Karula in the tree, looking at me like she'd been waiting for us the entire time. James must have just missed out on seeing her. She'd obviously just arrived. And then I looked even closer, and there was little Shungile sitting primly up at the top of the branches. These are leopards, by the way, for any of our new viewers. So one of those wonderful moments on a bushwalk. It's one of the reasons why I love being out on foot. And of course, Karula's a magic leopard on foot. She doesn't run away. She doesn't get angry or anything like that. She just watches you carefully, sees what you're doing. It helped that it was nice and open between us. So she'd seen us coming from a long way away, heard all of our chats as we were heading home, listened to whatever nonsense we were talking about, and watched us in her way. And then I looked up and she went, "Oh yes, you've noticed me." That was the expression on her face. "Yes, I've been here the whole time, watching you." And it was so funny because I was about to say to Aubrey, you know, that squirrel's gone completely crazy. It's chattering away. Then I realized the squirrel had actually seen two leopards. Now, after we got back, let's carry on. I'm going to try and find ourselves a slightly more shady patch because it is relatively hot this afternoon. So we're going to start walking towards the drainage line or the river systems of this area where there's some bigger trees. When we got back, we immediately took final control and Alex and Eggsy back out to go and see the leopards in the tree. And Hosanna was not with them. And we actually found his tracks crossing away from this area. He was going almost towards Treehouse Dam, actually. So I don't know whether or not he's made his way back. We watched her for a while. She was calling for him. I don't know whether or not they got separated or if he just is doing what young leopards do best, which is showing growing forms of independence by constantly moving, you know, moving a little bit further and further afield. So, who knows? Hopefully, fingers crossed, Hosanna has made him his way back towards Mom and his sister Shungile. But without any further ado, I heard that James was looking for them. Let's head over to him for a nice surprise this afternoon.
No, no. Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to the Karula sighting. There is Karula, the great queen of Juma. I'm just going to quickly turn down the game drive radio, which is so loud in my ear that I truly feel like my brain is going to explode. I'm okay now. Now, as Jamie was saying, we saw these two this morning. We also saw Hosanna, but not with them. And Jandre and I found a few baboons earlier, and we think maybe they came in between the slot, maybe they chased them again and split them up. Hosanna was actually on the same drainage line, but quite a long way down that way, probably about half a mile down to the sort of south, downstream as it were. So I don't know if they came past him on their way up here. I doubt it. I think he would have followed them. I think she will go back and look for the little male very shortly, or at some stage, probably tonight. Now, they did kill something, and she's looking directly towards the kill, and Jandre made a very good point as we got in here. That, of course, is a very rare occurrence that Jandre should make a good point. He is on camera, everybody. Well done, Jandre, for making a good point. And his good point was that she's unhoisted the kill, so she put it into this big jackalberry tree to the right-hand side, that very nice shady tree under which we're sitting now. She put it in there, but she's now moved it down onto a termite mound to the left-hand side. And Jandre's relatively good point was, why on earth would she take it out of a perfectly good tree and leave it there? And I think the answer is that because it's so small, I don't think it's, you know, conveniently easy to hook into any of the boughs of the tree. So there's a male impala, they often will hook the horns in between the boughs or in a fork, where something that little is often quite difficult to do. And because it's so easy to sort of cat handle, if you like, you like that, Jandre? No, you didn't like that. Cat handle, man handle, I think it's easier just to eat it on the ground, and it's so small that I think they'll probably finish it fairly soon. It's not impossible that Hosanna is around here somewhere, but I think he'd be eating, actually, if he was. So let's just sit here for a while, and we'll see what happens, and maybe later on we'll go and have a look. I'm just going to quickly call this in on the Game Drive channel. Station's relocated Karula and one youngster still to the western side of Quarantine. Best and best approaches to come on the western track that goes west of Quarantine, and then you will find tracks going west from there, about 300 metres from the junction with Vuya Tela access. Animals are static. Now, of course, that should be enough, but whether or not anyone would have heard me... And there is the Queen herself. Now, Brent's father, who is a fine naturalist himself, after we discussed the panting of leopards today, remember, they pant after they eat, and I said it was for two reasons. One, the diaphragm has pushed up against the lungs, and so it's difficult for them to breathe because the stomach is so full. Then, I said also, of course, there's a huge amount of oxygen needed to absorb the nutrients. And Brent's father, thankfully, didn't disagree with anything I said. But he said, I quote here, one of the reasons, in addition to what you said, is a factor called heat increment. This is the heating effect resulting from digesting meat and the active and therefore energies involved, absorbing of the broken down nutrients, and as you would expect, anything that involves the expending of energy produces extra heat as a byproduct and therefore needs to be lost. And as these predators can't sweat, they need to pant to lose the energy. Basically, what he said, and he was an animal scientist in his day, of course, now he's a businessman, but that the action of digestion creates metabolic heat, and that heat they have to get rid of. As we know, the cats, just like the dogs, do not have any kind of sweat glands, and so what happens is they must pant in order to get rid of that extra metabolic heat. Isn't that nice information? So you see, it comes from all quarters, the information, and that's courtesy of Mr. K. Leo Smith, father of Mr. BLS. Marvellous. Now, the other thing I wanted to say about this leopard, totally disconnected to the panting, she's obviously got four spots there on the left hand, her left, our right, yes, just behind that leaf. And if you don't know what I mean, I will explain this to you a little bit later. Hashtag Safari Life, questions at wildearth.tv if you've got any questions for us. Terms and conditions apply, batteries not included. And if you go to the other side, which she's not showing us now, we've always said that she's got three spots there, and I was looking at some photographs of her the other day. And on her right and our left, she's actually got four spots. There's a very light one there. And while I doubt she'll ever be known as the 4-4 female, that is what she is. They're the three. You see, 1, 2, 3, just behind the nostril there. And if you look just above and between the first two, there's a very faint little spot there. I don't know how that or why that's been sort of discounted in pretty much the same place that the fourth spot is on the other side. If you don't know what I'm talking about, you can see four spots there just above the whisker line, and those are used to identify a leopard. I mean, obviously, we know Karula from a thousand different ways, from the wow written across the front of her forehead, just to the look of her face, to the colour of her pelage, her coat, with a slightly, dare I say it, saggy skin around her belly. But she's got 100 different ways to identify this wonderful, wonderful leopard who so kindly shares her life with us. Isn't that marvellous? And then little Shongis, also hot, bothered, digesting food, trying to escape the flies. I think we'll probably sit here for about 20 minutes. Of course, these are two of our favourite characters in the whole world. And so even though they are flat and not doing a great deal, we'll sit with them for a little while. And then we might go off and see if we can find Hoshana and see what he's doing. We did struggle to find him again this morning, but we can do a little walk through the drainage line and see if we can't find him. Aaron, that's a really interesting comment from you. You say, looking at Karula and Shongile, it's like looking at Karula and her mini-me. You think that they look very similar. I tend to agree with you, Aaron, but were you to say the same about Hoshana, I would say no. I actually think that Shongile is starting to look quite a lot like Shadow. interestingly. She's got that kind of it's quite a severe look to her face. Shadow looks quite severe, and Shongile, although still imminently cute, especially when she's doing things like that, I think she's got that same sort of severity to her face. At least Hosanna, on the other hand, is a different color from these two. And I noticed that this morning. He's much more golden. And that's quite unusual for her lineage. Her lineage is generally fairly honey-colored. Can you see the resemblance with Shadow? There she looks up. Such a fat little belly. So that's very honey-colored. And I think that old Hosanna is a lot golder than that. And look at those feet. Those feet are almost the same size as her mother's. Now, Jandri and I was trying to work out this morning. We found some tracks of a leopard. And, I mean, we were a little bit baffled as to whose they were. And, in Jandri's case, that's okay. I however, expected to know. Unfortunately, I did not. And having looked at her feet now, they just look like a small female's tracks to me. I think they were Shongile's. They were just too little to be Karula's, but you can see that her feet are almost the same size now as her mum's. And I think Hosanna's are just slightly larger. Well done, Jandre. That's Jandre playing foot art. Now, Ilana, you're 13 years old and you started watching last week, and it's wonderful to have you with us. And you want to know, when I'm reading leopard spots, am I reading from left to right, or right to left, or their left to right, or our right to left, or how does it work? Now, this is a very, very good question. And what I'm going to do, I used to have a whole collection of little leopard diagrams in here, but unfortunately, I do not anymore. We are reading our left to right, so her right to left, okay? So if you're looking at Karula, she's got three on her right, our left, so you read it like a book, and four on our right, her left. Make sense? So she's 3, 4. Right? Is that right? No, she's 3 on her right and 4 on her left. But we read it from left to right as you would a book. That's the easiest way to remember it. Thank you, Jandre. Jandre is giving me the thumbs up. That's very unusual as well. Some lovely sounds of the summer. A grasshopper going tick, 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 tick. In fact, that's probably a cicada. One or two chin spot battis. Catherine, you possibly also a new viewer. That's wonderful to have you with us. You say, are there many leopards in this area, and do they live together? There are quite a few leopards in this area. It's one of the highest concentrations of leopards you probably find in Africa, which, and therefore anywhere in the world. And so, yes, there are lots, but no, they're completely solitary. And the only time you see leopards together, there'd be two reasons. One, a male and a female will have decided that they like each other quite a lot, and they'll be mating. And the other reason would be if you happen to find a mother and her cubs like this, and until they go independent, then they will be around with mum. Female, probably till she's about 16 months old, maybe a bit shorter, quite often a bit shorter, and the male till he's about 2 years old. Very nice. Look at her. So uncomfortable that she has to just put her foot up there. It's a bit like you after your enormous, enormous Sunday lunch, and then you just have to put your feet up on the sofa for a while. Now, Brent Leo Smith is hailing me on the blower. Let me attempt to get hold of him. For our new viewers, Brent Leo Smith, of course, another guide here. He's driving around some, well, dare we say, dignitaries from National Geographic who are here to visit us. So I'm just going to tell him where the sighting is. Go ahead. One must be quite firm with him, of course. Brent Leo Smith, go ahead. Go ahead. He wants to know which way to come, how to come. Brent, Leo Smith, I think your best approach is going to be to come from the, probably from the eastern side, western side of the drainage. There's not much space in here, especially for two cars. I'm in the drainage line. If you come around to the western side, I think that's going to be your best approach. And there we are. Isn't this wonderful? It's the most peaceful thing to be doing on a Saturday afternoon. It is Saturday, isn't it, Jean-André? Right, these leopards aren't going anywhere. Byron, however, has got something that might very shortly, so let's go and find out what it is.
Sorry, Anna. And we do have a beautiful bird of prey up in this tree, not too far from us. Now, I wonder if some of you at home can tell me what this bird is. I'm going to sit here a while. I'm going to give you a minute to try and get your answers in quickly. I don't think it's going to fly. So have a look at it. Tell me what you think, and then I shall reveal the answer. A beautiful bird of prey. It's a tricky one. It's not that easy. But I don't want to give you too many clues yet. We've still just been moving around, scanning for animal activity. I did see something very interesting, but just a brief glimpse. A pair of steenbok, which were just off to the side of the road, but they moved off. They are very shy antelope. But what was fascinating about them was the female. She was heavily, heavily pregnant, and she's definitely about to give birth to a little steenbok, and that would be incredible to see. I've never really seen, I think once or twice, I've seen a young steenbok, not a small one, not a newborn at all. I think they are really hidden when they're very, very young. And it was interesting to see. She's definitely within the next day or two, I'm sure. She was very, very pregnant. And I'm sure she's going to give birth soon. And the male was with her, which was lovely. Lovely to see a pair. We do know that the steenbok generally stay in pairs and they are monogamous. However, if one had to die or something happened to it, then the other one would then look for a new partner. But they do stay in a territory together. And they're mate for life, which is wonderful. Very different to some of the other antelope. Now, I wonder if we have any answers yet on the bird quiz. Now, Diane, you say a brown snake eagle. Unfortunately not. No, it is tricky, and I'll tell you why. So, Diane, you're on the right track, but if you look when you identify these birds of prey, if you have a look, this eagle doesn't have feathers all the way down the legs, so it's known as not being a true eagle. True eagles have feathers all the way down the legs, but a brown snake eagle doesn't, so you're on the right track there. Also, by the coloration and that, very, very close. However, a brown snake eagle has a very, very yellow eye, yellow ring around the eye, very easily, or you can see it very, very easily. Aaron, you say a bataleer, and that is correct. It is a immature or juvenile bataleer eagle and has not got the adult plumage just yet, or that beautiful black and white and that red face. This is a juvenile bataleer. It's perched up there, I think trying to get out of the heat, and that's why it's sitting in the shade of the tree. Lovely to see. And Valeria, you also got that right. Well done, well done. It's good that you're all trying and having a good look, but they are tricky to identify at times. We're going to continue. I'm going to head towards Biffleshoek Dam. As I said, it's very hot. Hopefully, I get some animals going down to drink. While I do that, let's head back to Jamie, who's out on a bushwalk.
Now, come and have a look at one of the biggest leopard tortoises that I've seen in this area, and also one of the luckiest ones. Hello, buddy. It's okay. I'm not sure if it's a male or a female. I think it's actually a female, judging by the short length of the tail that I can just see tucked underneath the shell. Now, the reason that she is a very lucky tortoise is, first of all, she's made it to a great age. I mean, this tortoise is, I've spoken before about this, I'm no expert at aging tortoises, but she's probably a good few decades old. This is a big leopard tortoise. They don't get all that much bigger than that. But have a look. It's okay, girl. Shame, it's all right. Have a look here. And the scarring on and the denting and the misshapenness of her shell. At some point, she has had a very lucky escape. Whether it was from something like a hyena, which is likely, or maybe a lion, or maybe a bird, although that is relatively unusual. Oh, shame, girl. I do love tortoises. It's all right. It's okay. Either way, at some point, she has had a very, very fortunate escape, and that's left her with a massive scar across her shell. And of course, her shell is made from bone. Her ribs and her spine is fused to the top of it, which means that that would have been quite an uncomfortable, quite a painful injury. And that's left, and she's actually very, very lucky to have survived, because the depth of that, to me, looks like it might even have broken through, right through this, to the skin below, to the flesh below. So our tortoise is one very, very fortunate girl. Obviously, we're not going to be picking her up. It's all right, girl. It's amazing how fast they can move when they want to, but now she's actually found herself a nice, slightly more comfortable position underneath a fallen log. It's amazing how fast little tortoises can actually motor when they want to. I don't really want to scare her. Ideally, I'd go around that side, but I think she is a little bit frightened of us. And the older tortoises tend to be more wary of humans. The little babies, like the one you've seen with Steph and myself, they're much more trusting. They're a great deal more relaxed with people than the older tortoises are. But for a leopard tortoise that could live up to 70 or so years old, this one has obtained pretty much close to her full life expectancy. She's an old girl. And leopard tortoises, like all tortoises, grow very, very slowly. But this is the biggest species of tortoise that we get. Our lovely little lady, big lady, just going round to the front. Hello, girl. You are beautiful. And one of my absolute favorite things, I do love a good tortoise sighting. They're fascinating. One of the reptiles with almost proper eyelids, which you'll have a chance to see. You can actually see her face a little bit better through here. If we have a look closely at her eye, you can see her blinking. And you can see the really hardened scales around her legs and her feet. There she goes. We're going to just let her slowly but surely move off. This is a grandmother tortoise, and she's earned the right to a little bit of space. Hey, girl. Look at you go. And the reason that I think it's a girl and not a boy tortoise is just the length of her tail, the fact that we can't really see it. It is tucked under. We can't really see it protruding from the shell. Male tortoises have slightly longer tails than females. And bye-bye, girl. Off she goes, looking to find some dense vegetation and maybe even a little bit of water to drink. It's one of the few, apart from being the longest-lived tortoise in the area, they're also one of the few left tortoises that can swim. The only tortoise that can swim. Oh, goodness. Brr, got up too fast. The world just did a little bit of a tilt. But yes, the only tortoise species that we get out here that can actually swim. I'm not going to follow her anymore, because she's definitely wants to get away from us. So I think that at her age, at her grand old age, if we just give her a little bit of space, I'm sure she'll be a great deal more comfortable if we back off a little bit. Shame. And of course, tortoises, when they are panicked, usually when you pick them up, they release the water that they've stored inside their bodies from something known as a bursa, which is basically like a modified bladder. And especially as a female, she could be pregnant. She might actually need that water to lay her eggs. Good, absolutely. very good question from Liz and Debbie. And since Gendre is full, I'm now relatively cautious about watching where the cameraman is about to walk. Don't want Vim to fall over. You are absolutely right, Liz and Debbie. It could well have been a ground hornbill that caused that injury. Probably when the tortoise was a little bit smaller, that would most likely be when that would have occurred. Just in terms of the size of that tortoise, that even a ground hornbill, which is a big, big bird, would have had a struggle even getting its claws around or perhaps its mouth around that particular tortoise. But when it was little, when she was a tiny little thing, then that might have been when she obtained that injury. It's amazing how resilient they are, that she managed to actually recover from that. And I apologize, by the way, for the ink that is all over my hands. I had a minor incident with a stamp. We need stamps to get out of the gate here, and I tried to stamp somebody's exit stamp and promptly sprayed ink everywhere. Might be a nice spot, Viam, don't you think? On a day like today. Except that it smells. It actually smells quite terrible. Now, if I were a warthog or a buffalo, I would go and plant myself right in the middle of this and have a jolly good wallow. And in fact, since I forgot to put sunblock on this afternoon, a decision which I am most annoyed with myself, not a decision, a mistake, which I'm most annoyed with myself, would probably work very well as a type of sunscreen. I'm not quite brave enough, though. I don't really want to go and climb and rub into this mud. It's very stinky, especially because there have been lots of hippo and lots of buffalo that will have spent time in here. That's very squidgy. This could end badly. There we go. I'm just checking to see whether or not there's any tracks, interesting tracks to show you. Perhaps a tortoise has come for a swim, or perhaps a warthog has come for a wallow, but it doesn't look that way. I think what we're going to do is carry on in search of some more shade and places to cool off. Let's go over to Byron and find out what his plan is from here on out.
So, while Jamie looks for some shade, we're still out driving, having a look, heading towards Biffle's Hook Dam. And I'm sure it's very hot out on the walk. I mean, we got this cool breeze while we're driving, but it's still very, very warm. Let us go down here, Brian. I saw a quick flash of a bird earlier that looked like perhaps the Eurasian golden oriole. Now, we used to seeing the black-headed oriole, which is a beautiful, beautiful bird, and I'll show you a picture quickly of them. Let me find some shade quickly so you can see it a bit better. I'm also going to try to just stop and listen out. See if we can't hear any elephants, perhaps. I know there were some elephant on the weird tailor earlier. Alright, so this is the black-headed oriole, which we are all used to seeing. That is the beautiful bird that we see quite regularly, and we hear it a lot here in this area. I'll just show you some pictures of it. They're a beautiful, beautiful bird. Golden yellow with that black head, very easy to identify. Then we've got, don't worry, too soon to panic, the Eurasian golden oriole, which is a migratory species of oriole, but do you notice it hasn't got that black head at all? It's got some black on the wings, a lot more black on the wings, but golden yellow, but no black on the head. And I thought I caught a glimpse of this flying past, but very, very secretive. Sorry, I thought I saw something or heard something move. Hang on a second. I think I've got a little stowaway. Now, what is it? I hope it's nothing, have a look here. Hang on. Give me a second. and try to save this guy. You're playing hard to get now, aren't you? There we go. Hello. Stowaway. Hang on. Let's try to show you to everyone. I'm getting caught in wires and trying to catch the dung beetle. Stay there for a second. Here we go. Look at that. Isn't he beautiful? Look how quickly... Sorry, I don't want to hurt him, but look how quickly he flicks himself back up. Look at that. Isn't that amazing? Okay, come. I'll put you off. There we go. Off you go. And there he is. Now he's moving back towards the vehicle again. But what a tenacious little dung beetle. They're so powerful, it's hard to explain. But you can really feel them pushing and kicking their legs when they are moving around. Nice to see him. But how quickly could he just flip back off of his back? Just a quick little flip and back on his feet and off he goes again. So he was catching a little ride with us. That was a fairly large dung beetle. And perhaps a little camera shy. Oh, just caught a glimpse of a roller flying past. A lilac-breasted roller. And I've spotted him. Brian, I wonder if you, at the top of that tree, if you can, I don't know what the light is like for you. Through the back of a dead tree, you might be able to see it through there. There we go. Let's see if we can see it. See the light. It's very, very difficult at the moment because it's so bright. Yeah. Even with the camera's settings, it still makes it very difficult to make out. Yeah. But it is a lilac-breasted roller. Oh dear. This morning we got a question about the mail lions. Somebody wanted to see the mail lions and was hoping we'd see one or two of those, the other males that are part of the Birmingham Coalition that we haven't seen for quite some time. We saw one the other day. He was here with the two brothers, Ntinio and Mfumo. But it sounds like two males are north of our boundary on Biffle's Hook. Someone else found them this morning, and I just heard they drove past them about 10 minutes ago. They're still in that same area. So they're quite far from the Unkahuma Pride, probably a few kilometers, so 3 or 4 miles apart as the crow flies. It's a completely different area to where they are. But maybe they meet up during the course of the evening. You never know. Okay, we're fairly close to Biffle's Hook Dam, I think. Just hopefully I haven't got my direction lost completely. I haven't seen any sign of elephant tracks or anything yet while we're driving along, but you never know. Wouldn't it be wonderful if we arrived at the dam and there's a herd of elephant drinking and splashing water and mud on themselves? That would be great. And we're almost there. This buffalo carcass just off to the right over here is not smelling particularly good at all. That's an old carcass. Not much left. Oof, sure. Especially in this heat. Not a nice smell at all. All right, let's have a look. We're at the dam. And have we got any elephants? No, it doesn't look like it at all. Dearie me. I'm just having a look around and no sign of any animals here, which is strange. It is strange, but it happens like that sometimes. What I might do is I might change and try head down towards the drainage lines where it's a lot cooler. Maybe we get some animals moving through there. But the other reason why I wanted to have a look is to see if the elephant have come through. I'd probably see where they'd splashed water out and on the banks around the water hole or the dam. There's no sign of any activity here at all. So perhaps they're still moving through the thickets feeding. Let's see if we can find them. I know they were at Juma Dam earlier today, so maybe we're lucky and we can still find them. While I do that, James is still with that female leopard. Let's go and have a look.
Jane. Now, there has been very little activity since you left us last. Karula actually just did get up and said hello to Shungile before going back to sleep just behind where we are now. So we'll give you a view of her just shortly. But they haven't gone to eat, and I think they've done a huge amount of eating in the last few days. I don't think that Karula was hungry when she killed that impala, especially given how we saw Hosanna. If you weren't with us on drive this morning, we saw little Hosanna, and he looked very satiated indeed. He didn't look in the slightest bit hungry. So I think they've probably come off a kill towards this area. And I think that's why they're not looking particularly enthusiastic about the meal their mother has prepared for them. And I say them, but Hosanna is not here right now. We'll try and find him a little bit later on. Can you see Karula Jandri? There she is. Jandre is not very happy because it's not the best picture in the world. He gets very upset if the picture isn't very nice, you see. He's an artiste. Now, I think what we're going to do, everyone, I have said this a little bit earlier, but I think we'll sit here for another 10 minutes, then we'll head down and see if we can't find Hosanna. And then we'll come back here a little bit later. I'm kind of missing this name here. I think it's Padsley. Is it Padsley in the Four Ways, Johannesburg? Paz. P-A-S-Lee. Pasley. Pasley. That's an interesting name. You say, will her territory stay the same her whole life, or might she move? It does stay pretty much the same, Pasley. It will expand and contract on either, you know, north, south, east or west slightly, dependent on pressure from other leopards. So she'll have a core area which will remain pretty much unchanged. And then let's say about a fifth, if you take a radius of a circle and about a fifth on the outside, will expand and contract depending on pressure from leopards that are living around her territory. But she would never sort of move completely. I'm sure leopards have done it. Just about every kind of phenomena you can think of has happened in biology. But I think you'll probably find that it's extremely rare for a leopard to move completely from her territory. That's another safari vehicle there, being driven by the inimitable Brent Leo Smythe. Now, for those of you also who haven't been watching of late, Shungile has made 2 kills so far, on her own completely. Both of them, as far as we know, squirrels. I mean, she may well have made many others while we haven't been watching. There we go, scrub hair on Arethusa, as Jandre says. Thank you, Jandre, for that. If you could say it slightly less acerbically next time, that would be great. He says he doesn't know what acerbic means. I'll educate him shortly. And that's interesting because, of course, she will most likely go independent before him. And so she's starting to kind of sort herself out. But interestingly, he was on his own today. He didn't look uncomfortable at all. And, yeah, they're both, I guess, starting to assert some form of independence at this stage. It's very early for a male to be on his own.
but not unusual for him to be on his own for a day or two. Christine and Kathy, a nice question from you about whether or not leopards can have green eyes or multicolored eyes, or, you know, what kind of eyes they have. Sometimes they maintain blue, but normally it's the kind of color that she's actually got quite brown eyes. Hers are unusually brown, but her brothers and mothers are the most common leopard color. It's a kind of greeny, it's a greeny color. I wouldn't, I mean, how would you describe it, John? There's a kind of pale lime green, I suppose. It's actually it's almost like a honeyed yellow green, if you like. It's not very striking. Hers are strikingly brown, and the Mvula, for example, one of the males who we used to see quite frequently, his eyes are pretty much blue. And interestingly, while I talk about Mvula, of course, his territory has shifted, and it's shifted almost. I wouldn't say completely out of where it was before, but it's certainly contracted hugely, probably because of pressure. This is a famous trait of the Queen, everybody. She likes to stick her tongue out. It's not very royal, is it, Jandre? Stick your tongue out like that. Long whiskers. Nobody's entirely sure what whiskers are for. Here comes the leopard. Come, Jandre, the little one's coming towards us. She likes the look of Jandre, you see. He's got quite a lot of flesh on his legs, and I think maybe she's looking at him thinking, I wonder if that tastes like chicken. I am, of course, talking absolute rubbish. I don't think Jandre's legs would taste like chicken at all, but she's also not looking at him for any other reason. Then she's a little bit bored, she's a little bit uncomfortable because her stomach's so full and she's hot, and so they're just a bit like us tossing and turning when we're in bed and hot and uncomfortable. That's what she's doing. But she's now so close that I actually can't see her. I can only see her in the monitor that I'm looking at. Now, Tucker, you're just 4 years old. Hello, boy. I hope you're having a good time on safari with us today. You want to know if the mum is cross that her little boy, Hossan, has not bothered to stay with her, that he's run away. Tucker, he hasn't run away. He's just down. He's actually not too far from here. He's just a little bit lost, and he's getting older now. I know that he seems very young, but he's basically like a human being who's, say 13 years old. So he's just starting to be okay. It's like he's going shopping on his own, or maybe riding his bicycle to school on his own. So no, his mum's not cross with him at all. She'll be happy to see him again, I'm sure, but she's not cross with him. All right, let's head back across to Jamie. She's on foot. I don't know what she's got. Let's go and find out.
Well, I have no doubt that very shortly Hosanna will make his way back to Mom, or perhaps even Mom will go and find him. In the meantime, speaking of finding things, have a look at this incredible black and white jumping spider that VM has found for us.
He left, so we need to go to the inn.
We need to go to the inn. There he is.
Oh, come back.
Sorry, yes. sorry, VM. VM thought our jumping spider had disappeared, but he is in fact still there, and he is in fact still fascinating looking, and I'm a bit more concerned about the spider vanishing than the stick insect. The stick insects have a tendency to stay. Jumping spiders do not. And isn't this little one beautiful? There are so many different types of jumping spiders, but you can actually really see the detail in their faces, and I always feel like they're one of the most mischievous looking spiders. They always look like they're up to trouble, up to something no good. Watch the jump. He might actually jump now. He looks like he's thinking about it. You see he's weighing up his options. It's absolutely astounding the way in which they power themselves forward. Oh no, he's just hiding now. What are you gonna do if I do that? Oops, sorry, VM. There we go. He should be called a zebra jumping. There we go, one hop. So active little hunters. He's on the lookout for food. Oh, not food. That was very funny. He jumped on me and then decided, actually, I really, really don't want to be on that thing. And he jumped off again. Avia mentioned a stick insect at the start, and the stick insect I'm less worried about it disappearing. They are always incredible. The ability of these creatures to camouflage themselves is absolutely breathtaking. And this particular one is beautifully designed. In fact, all of them will do this. He looks at the moment as though he's got four legs, and that's because two of his legs are actually stretched out in front of his body, in front of his head, to even better to sort of carry on the facade of being a stick. I don't know if any of you remember Steve the stick insect that we had on Cheetah Plains. He was a much, much larger version of this particular stick insect. They're fascinating little creatures, they really are. I mean, they really, from a distance, unless you happen to be sitting right up close, which is what I was doing because I was looking at the jumping spider, unless you happen to be looking right up close, you would never ever know that they're there. And how birds manage to spot them, I just don't know. I was about to grab the jumping spider because it was on a stick, but it's just jumped off again. Bear with me one moment. I'm going to try and catch it. Not catch it, I just want to try and get it up close to the camera without it jumping away, which might actually prove to be next to impossible. Here, don't you want to jump onto that? There, look, see? There, you want to jump onto that. I'm sure you do. There you go. See, I told you you wanted to jump onto that. Okay, this could end very interestingly. Right, at any second now, he is going to jettison off this piece of bark and vanish. But it just does give us a really nice opportunity to examine him up close and personally. With their bright eyes, am I holding him still enough for you, Viam?
Yes.
Cool. Oh, where are you going? You're going into my hand? No, no. Already been there, don't want to stay there. There he goes, now he's going to go onto my thumb. See what I mean about the mischievous eyes? You will have had a brief view of them there. They're actually quite beautiful spiders, and this is a particularly beautiful one. They've got adorable faces. They've also got quite sharp and quite powerful chelicera. In other words, the biting parts. But I'm just going to pretend that I'm a part of this bark, and hopefully he decides not to bite me. If he does, I'll survive.
He walks in stop motion.
Yes. Like a little robot. That is so cool. It's actually quite, oh my word, it's actually quite disconcerting. Once you notice it, you can't unsee it. And now what? Now where are we going? You can't disappear in amongst the freckles, buddy. Where are you gonna go? Shame. They're cute, aren't they? They're jumping spiders you can actually really learn to love. If you look at them in the face, right in the face, they've got such adorable expressions. Now he's looking at Viam, looking to see where he can jump to next. Cat in Tampa says that jumping spiders are one of the reasons that she has trust issues. I hear you, Kat. I hear you. He's about to jump straight into my face. I could just feel it. He's looking at my face. He's looking at me in the eye. And he's actually testing my nerve here. I'm going to slowly turn him so that he'll go back onto the piece of bark, or hopefully he does. Trust issues. I know exactly what you mean, though, because they do look like small, innocuous spiders until they launch themselves straight at you. And you get huge ones. You get ones that are at least double this chap's size. And you get tiny ones as well. We saw a tiny one on walk this morning. But this is the prettiest, I think this is the prettiest jumping spider I've ever seen, with his beautiful zebra black and white. He's very attractive, aren't you? Yes, it's about to jump into the camera. That's what it feels like. I actually think he's really thinking about it. He's gathering himself, looking up at the camera. I'm desperately trying to stay still, which gets harder the more you think about it. Is he going to jump? Is he going to jump? Okay, let me pop him down before he does actually launch himself onto the camera itself. Hey, buddy. Alrighty, thank you. Thank you. You can go. There we go. Bye-bye. And off he goes. The joys of jumping spiders and stick insects and other such things. And the whole time we've been there with our jumping spider, Sticky the stick insect hasn't moved at all. Here we go, Sticky. You can stay there. And he's gone. Our little jumping spider's decided he's had enough of these weird people. And he's off. Now, somewhere here, It was a grasshopper, but it has vanished. Unless I'm blind, which is entirely possible because they are so camouflaged, but I think I'm blind. I think he's gone. Oh well, we've had enough jumping things for one segment, I think. I've had enough of trying to keep my hands still whilst spiders are jumping all over them. Anything else? No. It's amazing what you see. The longer you stay somewhere, the longer you stay in one spot, the more you actually find, whether it's the jumping spider and the stick insect, which Viam spotted, actually, right down to the antlion holes that are spread out throughout this area. Oh, this one's actually got an antlion in it. Oh, what is that? What on earth is that? See what I mean about staying in one spot? That is utterly bizarre. Wait, stop. What are you? What on earth is that? It's a spider with a... I think I've seen the spider before. I'm pretty sure it is actually a spider. Now that I can see its legs. No, wait. I just want to look at you. I have no idea. That is so cool. It looks like he's gathered up. Wait, just stop for a second. Stop moving, please. Okay, if it is a spider, it's missing a... It's got six legs. Maybe it is a spider. It's some kind of insect. Sorry to be really unhelpful there. It is some kind of insect that's gathered bits of dirt and bark on top of it. And I have seen one of these now that I think about it. But isn't that just genius camouflage? You saw the stick insect earlier. And now we've got this thing. This fascinating thing. It's not a spider. I don't think it's a spider. But it is a something. It's got long furry legs. Either that or its legs are covered in dirt. Long antenna. And it's got the most amazing camouflage. I can't quite work out if that's genuine bark and dirt or if it's grown like that. Excuse me, can you come back here for a second? You're fascinating me. Its legs are all furry, but they're covered in dirt. It looks as though it's got grass seeds on it, but it definitely only has six legs. So unless it's a very unfortunate spider, which is also possible, I don't think it's a spider. That is so cool. It's coming for you, Viam. Aaron, you wanted to know what is my favorite time of year to do a bushwalk. It's a difficult one, Aaron. It depends on what it is I'm after. The bushwalks that I used to do, this is... Learning to do these sorts of bushwalks for our Safari Live has been a different experience because it's not the walks that I used to do. We used to mission for 6 hours at a time, have a specific destination or a specific animal in mind to track, and then carry on from there. So this has been a different experience. So for me... probably one of my favorite times to walk would have been in perhaps late summer, or even actually early spring, because then the temperatures weren't too hot and we could walk far, but there'd still be a little bit of water in the river, so not right in the middle of the dry season. But now I'm actually feeling like midsummer and just after the rains is one of my favorite things, because with this camera you can see more than perhaps you'd stop and see with the normally while you were walking through the bush, and that I really enjoy. It's also nice, I have to be honest, at the moment walking around, because it does feel like with the rain, it's just taken an edge off the animals here. I've been feeling a little bit like everything is very on edge, it's particularly buffalo and elephant. It's just, and hippo, of course. And the hippo are still struggling and the buffalo are still thin, but it doesn't feel quite so pressurized. This place is starting to feel a little bit like a pressure cooker in terms of the drought. And there were just buffalo around every corner, and it's nice walking now. It's very comfortable. It's very warm though. So I'm not sure. It's a difficult one. There's more bugs around in summer in the rainy season. Right, I am now thoroughly dirty. So I'm going to do some sweeping of myself to get rid of all of the dirt that I've gathered, lest I start looking like that insect. In the meantime, let's go and find something that I think would dearly like to eat it.
And look at that beautiful view of the green wood hoopoe. Oh, that is wonderful. That very, very bright red beak. I'm hoping the sun hits it, you'll see the beautiful iridescence on the body. It seems to be, it's typical wood hoopoe behavior, jumping around looking for insects. Let's just see where it decides to go. Come on, jump into the light for us. Now, there are a few of them around. Some have just flown off. This one's still just hanging around in the tree. So we've gone a little bit lower, Brian, I think. There it is. And they are communal birds. You always find a group of them together. They're very gregarious, always in little groups. See if the others are around. I'm just scanning. I can't see the others at the moment. But they are beautiful birds. And it's not often you get to see one sitting and jumping around a tree like this. They often fly quite quickly. Now, the interesting thing with these birds is they do something known as allomimetic calling. And oh, there it goes. It's flown off. Now, the allomimetic calling is basically group calling. So when these birds start calling, I'm trying to see if I can't see any others. Really can't. It's strange. There should be a few others around. But when one starts calling, they all call together as a group, and you get this chorus between all these birds together calling. It's called allomimetic calling. It's group calling. It's social behavior that they do. Now, the green wood hoopoe do it. What else do it? Some of the helmetrikes. The helmetrikes do it. The southern white-crowned helmetrike and the Retz's helmetrike. They do it. Another bird that does it. Arrow-marked babblers. That's a good one. I'm sure you would have all heard them. They all, when they fly together, they all call together. It's all that allomimetic calling. Now, we have had a fairly... Hang on a second. I can just hear a bird alarm calling. Sounds like a starling. I just want to have a look quickly, see what it's calling. Perhaps a snake. It could also be a mongoose. Hold on. Where is it now? Can't see it. It was a little bit far from us. Hold on. Sorry, it's behind us a little bit. Let's just have a look here, because usually when these birds call like this, and it's mobbing something there. You know what? I'm gonna go have a look. Hold on. You know what? It's going very quickly. I think it's possibly just a mongoose. Let's just double check. There it is, under the tree. It's a slender mongoose. Oh, just running off. Can you see it there, Brian? Did you get a glimpse? A little slender mongoose. Where did they? Oh, just across the clearing. It's so quick, unfortunately. But that's what it was. So as I said, it could be a snake or a mongoose. It was a mongoose. I just wanted to double check for you quickly. And that slender mongoose, the reason that bird would be alarm calling at it and trying to mob it and chase it away is the mongoose may try and feed on eggs or little chicks if it does come across any of those. So that's why the birds will mob it and try to chase it away. Into the bit so quick, very, very shy little creature, so quick. But if it was a snake, we could have potentially had a lovely sighting of a snake. It's always great just to have a look, just to check. But it's amazing how birds can alert you to certain predators being around. Interesting little things that you can find in the bush. Now, I've come back towards Juma Dam, Vuyatela Dam, Galago Dam. It's all the same dam. And I just wanted to have a look around and see if there was anything close by and drinking around here. I wonder if these animals are not, if they know something we don't, because we're struggling to find little animals this afternoon. Now let's see if there are any interesting birds around here, perhaps. There's a terrapin out in the open, to the left-hand side there's a little island sticking into the water, and you'll see there's a terrapin basking in the sun. There he is, in the back. Now, a terrapin is a freshwater turtle. The other difference is the terrapins are able to move their necks to the side, and I don't think turtles can do that, if I'm not mistaken. So the terrapins actually, when they get disturbed, they tuck their heads in, but to the side. Also different to tortoises, who pull their necks in to stay away from danger. So no sign of those elephants that were in this area earlier today. I don't know where they disappeared to. Perhaps they headed north out of Juma, out of Vuyatela. I think, why don't we go and see if we can find the Unkahuma pride. There's not much else going on at the moment this afternoon. Let's see, maybe they're still around. I'm hoping they haven't moved off. Perhaps they just moved down into the drainage line or just further into the shade. Excuse me. Birds around at the moment. You can hear a lot of birds. Woodland kingfishers are calling, the starlings are calling, some fork-tailed drongos. There's a lot of sounds coming around or that we can hear around us, but just no sign of a lot of wildlife. We've seen the few impala, and but not much else for the moment. There we go, there's some impala and some lambs off to our right. Hang on. Let me see if I can get us a nice view through there, perhaps. Brian, how's that for you? There we go. Two little lambs. Oh, I love seeing them at the moment. It is a lovely time of year. Nice to see these little lambs with the females, and there are just two of them here. I'm surprised there aren't more. There may be a few more hiding in the thicket somewhere. You can see they all move through the thickets, try and stay in a little bit of shade where they can stay cool, and off they go. Nice to see them. Lovely to see the impala lambs. Very, very cute. All right, we are going to try to start the vehicle, for one. Oh, dear. Might need a hand later. Someone can come tow us. All right, so we're going to head towards the last position of the Unkahuma pride to see if we can find them. While I do that, let's head back to James and get an update from him.
The reason I'm smiling, of course, is because I was singing Byron's Link, and you know, one loses concentration every so often. There's a duiker. Do you see it, Jandri? Oh, it's running away. Beastly, beastly, beastly animal. Anyway, what we did was we went to look for Hosanna. We went on foot. Jamie is definitely in that area, and I'm not sure if she said that she was looking for him, but I suspect quite strongly, given her footprints and those of Aubrey and who was filming her? Viam. Yes, I'm pretty sure they're looking for him as well. So we left the area, we wandered about a bit, didn't find any tracks or signs, so we'll let him be, I think, for now. We're going to go down to Treehouse Dam. I think it's the only body of water that Byron hasn't checked. What have you spotted? Ooh. Well spotted, Jean-André. There's a road, everybody. It's having a dust bath. That's why its colours are so dull. Hello. Yes. Go on, as you were. Now he's looking for something to eat while he dust baths. He's eating stone. That's probably going into his gizzard. Isn't that cool? Is that a stone or is it a seed? No, I think it's a stone. So, I mean, a rola is ostensibly an insect-eating bird, and they will eat stones. It's not unusual for a bird to eat stones. They have a very muscular little pouch, sort of just below the throat, called a gizzard. And that muscular pouch, yeah, sort of twists and turns, a bit like a washing machine, I suppose, but with stones. And what that does is crush up whatever they eat. And that's important if you don't have teeth, of course. And in the case of a rola, because it's an insect eater by and large, it eats a huge amount of what we call chitin, which is the chemical that the exoskeleton of insects... There it goes. It's that chemical that the exoskeleton is made of. Oh, it's beautiful, Jean-André. Was this Blurry Safaris?
Yes.
Eggsy-inspired. Anyway, so that gizzard chops up that indigestible chitin and then it obviously goes through the body. Isn't that cool? Oh, now there are two confessions I have to make. It's going to be very difficult for me, Jean-André. The first confession is the following. I was told in no uncertain terms on Twitter by some very kind viewer that I was speaking an untruth of nonsense the other day when I was asked, is it only owls that are able to produce a pellet? Now, for those of you who don't know, owls produce pellets when they swallow something whole and they spit up often sort of claws and keratin and hair from whatever they've eaten and they spit them down. And I was asked after we watched a kingfisher eating a scorpion whether they too produce pellets, to which I confidently asserted that no, only owls produce pellets because only they, or very few other birds, swallow their mammalian prey whole. The rest of them chop it up and feed it, so definitely only owls that produce pellets. It turns out that owls, herons, kingfishers, eagles, kestrels, I think some shrikes, various other birds also produce pellets. So in fact, the question is more the better, which birds do not produce pellets, and it would seem very few is the answer. So that is my first confession. My second confession is that my sort of source of internet knowledge, Judy H, sent me a very slightly more gentle tweet the other day, and I've spoken consistently since I began here of the fact that elephants and human beings go through menopause because, of course, of the important repositories of knowledge that older animals are. Judy found some article, a National Geographic article, very nice article, about the fact that elephants do not, in fact, go through menopause. They produce babies until just about the day they die. The only animals that have menopause at all, human beings, orcas, so killer whales, and another species of pilot whale. Those are the only mammals that we know of that go through, look at that, that go through menopause. Isn't that gorgeous? Those are not orcas, or pilot whales, or indeed human beings. They're kudu, and they do not go through menopause, Jean-André. No. That is wonderful. I'm just going to be quiet and just listen to the heat of the afternoon. It is hot. What I'd like you to try and hear is the flies buzzing There's an oriole calling deep in the background. And just try and almost taste the heat. It's quite close, it's quite humid. And everything feels like it's quite hot. And slowly the sound that you can hear now is going to ramp up as it cools. So I'd say in about half an hour things will start to cool down. And then the birds will start to sing a bit more, their final evening chorus. Andre and I have both looked suddenly to the left because there's a woodpecker pecking somewhere. We can hear it, but we cannot see it. It is going peck, 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 peck. It's here. Let's just sneak slowly forward. I'll stop talking as though I'm going trying to put you to sleep shortly. Now, I suspect from the very quiet nature of the pecking that it is a cardinal woodpecker, our smallest woodpecker species. I think it's either on this small tree here or the one behind. Chandri, do you still hear the gentle peck, peck, pecking of the woodpecker? You do? I don't either. All I hear is spider-hunting wasps and heat. All right, we're close to Treehouse Dam. Let's go look there. Thank you, Steve, very much for your comment. I was postulating yesterday why it is that birds move their heads when they move, and you said parallax is the answer, which of course is, well, a sort of a way of describing the way a bird will, because it's got eyes on the sides of its head, it's not, well, a bird like the black-bellied bustard we were looking at yesterday has eyes on the sides of its head. It's moving to get depth of perception. Thank you for that, Steve. I have spotted a very, very elegant antelope through the midst of the trees there. Let's drive slightly up here and we'll have a look. There it is. Look at it. It's not even running away. Indeed, it seems quite chuffed to be on screen. There it is. It says, hi, everybody. Next to it is something not quite as elegant. There we go. Something akin to... Oh, that's very nice. That is a, I'm not sure what that is actually, it looks like a sort of small yeti. Yes, it is a small yeti, and then to the left of that, ah, excellent, the dominant male, Aubrey. Right, let's head straight across to the elegant antelope there, who is giggling, of course, because she knows what I'm saying, doesn't she? Nod your head, that's it, nod your head, yes, there we go, uh-huh.
I'm having a jolly good chuckle at James's commentary. It's always highly entertaining. This is now the second time today that we have bumped into James on the road. Bye-bye, Jandre. Bye-bye, James. Bye-bye. Watch out for Treehouse Dam. I can't believe he called VM a small yeti. VM, I'm going to stand for that. I don't think so. You're just going to park his car in for a week. Aha. I don't think he'd like that at all, and your car is much bigger than his. There we go. Sorted. Problem solved. The minor disputes between various team members resolve themselves as parking wars. And Aubrey, James says apparently you're the alpha male of the group. We're actually in the block north of Treehouse Dam. Now, I know that James mentioned the fact that we were looking for Hosanna. We're not actually actively looking for him, although I think there is a chance we could stumble into him at some point. The last tracks we had were this morning, after we'd finished off with our dung beetle, which I think rounded off the rest of the afternoon. And his tracks were coming not quite in this direction, but roughly in this direction. So we did have him moving about in this area. Brent says he was just chasing squirrels. I'm not sure what was happening with our lovely little Hosanna and why he was away from Mom. I think he's going to be doing that more and more frequently. But I think there's a chance that we could actually bump into him. Although I still have yet to walk Karula's cubs on foot while they're away from Mom. So it could be that he could be watching us this entire time and had just run away. Now, Naomi, you wanted to know, and Naomi is from Pretoria. Naomi, you wanted to know whether or not if the two cubs separate from each other and they bump into each other months later, would they recognize each other? Yes, I think they would. There's a lot of debate about how leopards recognize each other. I think every leopard in an area knows individuals, and I think especially with their siblings, and particularly in their first stages of life, they haven't quite established territories. They're not inclined to be as aggressive as they might otherwise. Of course, our leopards are very beautiful, but there are lots of very beautiful things out here. Let us head across to Byron and see what beautiful things he's found for you.
And we've got the whole Nkuhuma pride, Jamie. They have probably moved 5 meters from this morning, so it wasn't too difficult to find them again, fortunately. And there is still a bit of shade around, I think that's why they've just stayed here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, all 5 females, and 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, where's the other cub? I'm trying to count now. Not sure exactly where they are. It's hard to see, I think. There's one lying there, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Where's the other one? Must be lying somewhere here, maybe behind that other lioness that we just considered. Oh, beautiful woodland kingfisher again, right above us. And there it goes, just flown off as they usually do. Now there were two of them here earlier this morning, so I wonder if there isn't perhaps a nest, or they are thinking of nesting in this tree. I see there are some holes around here. What I would like to show you, and I think James showed it to you today. Well, there's a little hole in the trunk of that tree, but look at that beautiful flower below it. And that is, of course, the leopard orchid. Beautiful leopard orchid. So I wonder if we can try to get a bit closer on those flowers, Brian. Is it possible? You get yellow with those brown spots. That is, wow, that's amazing. Look at that. Isn't that magnificent? The beautiful leopard orchid. Ancilia africana. That's the scientific name of the leopard orchid. So we have a leopard, orchid, and lions. Ah, that joke never gets old. Oh, there's a little yawn from that cub. Oh, look at them. Oh, that's the other cub is in there too. I just saw it now. So they're all 6 cubs. Yep. All 6 cubs and all 5 lionesses, which is great. Nice to see the whole family back together. It seems as if they are having a very lazy Saturday. And I tend to forget what day it is out here. But James had to shoot into town quickly today, so that's how we knew it was Saturday, because he told us. So, but we do forget, we do lose track of days out here, but that's the wonderful thing about being in the bush, I suppose. We've got some visitors at the moment too that are doing a bit of work in the area, and it's great to have some people coming in and staying. They're actually staying in Vuyatela at the moment, and they are going on game drives with, well, James and Brent have taken them out already, which is nice. So they're getting a feel for what Safari Live is all about, what we do out here, and getting to go on game drives and viewing all the animals that we have in the area, which is great. It's nice to, as I said, nice to just have some company around. We get to chat about different things and have a few people, just a change of scenery, I suppose. For us, not that it's not great in the DRC. We do have a lot of fun there, but it is nice to have other people around. And we had dinner last night at Vuyatela, which was lovely. Beautiful view from the deck, obviously, of the Juma waterhole or the Vuyatela waterhole. You can hear the woodland kingfisher's back. He's sitting. Where is he? I can't see him now. This is a very peaceful scene indeed. I'm sure those of you who are watching are just enjoying watching these lions rest and, you know, the flick of the tail keeping the flies away, some of the cubs, one or two of the cubs cleaning themselves, lion is rolling over. It's lovely, it's very, very nice, and you know, I do think it's just so such a fortunate sighting to be able to sit so close to these wild animals, and for them to allow us here really is just a great experience, and it's so peaceful. As we said, the birds calling in the distance. There's some nice shade around. Look, have a look, this lioness is off to the right. Her paws, she's managed to put her paw in the tree. She's resting it on the branch. Look at that. It's almost as if these lions know that it's the weekend and that they need to rest. They've had a long week. Long week in the office. Trying to find food. You know, it's funny. I'm just watching this little cub off to the left. He's just rolling. Hang on, there it goes, just rolled onto his back and then off to the side again, that little one. Now I was watching that little one, and it was, its leg was twitching a little bit. Now I do sometimes wonder, do they dream of chasing antelope or chasing one another? Because you see them sometimes, the legs twitch a little bit, but I'm not sure. I mean, I really don't know. And how would we know? Maybe it is just muscles twitching. I think we're going to sit with these lions a little bit longer, just in case they... Oh. woodland kingfisher agrees with me. Sit and just spend some time here. Now, why don't we go back to J.R.H. Henry, and you know that stands for James Reginald Humphrey. Let's see what he has got.
Byron, of course, is the least funny human being in the world, as you've just noticed. There is a little couple of Egyptian gooses and their little goslings. They've got eight of them, hopefully slightly more competent parents than the ones at Bivelshoek Dam, who are the worst parents in the Sabi Sand. Aren't they sweet? Oh, that's just wonderful. Now, they're coloured like that, I suspect, because if you put them in a little bit of shade, they probably are rendered almost completely invisible. They're already very good swimmers, and I suspect they're probably no more than a day or two old. Isn't that cool? I don't know if that's mom or dad. It's almost impossible to tell the difference, but they are both very attentive parents, and they both make equal effort. Look at them climbing over those things, jumping up and down, completely sure-footed. So cool. And they'll be eating bits of algae, basically. That's all they're eating at the moment. excuse me, everybody. I'm there, sorry. That must have blown a couple of speakers. Thank you. Oh, look at them walking. A little bit like me when I walk, don't they, Jean-André? Mm-hmm. I'm quite duck-footed myself. And an Egyptian goose, of course, puts its nest in a tree. So these things, no, they must be much more than a day or two old. That's nice when Mum just stands on you, eh? That's beautiful. Now, we've got a couple of other nice things around here at Twin Dams. I wasn't so much thinking there. Yes, well done. We've got some waterbuck drinking in a much more attractive little pan down there, shaded by some young cambrium bushes. Here we are. Gentle reflection of the summer vegetation down to the left. And the one on the right, Jean-André, has just looked up. What do you think it's looking at? No, Jean-André, it's looking at a baboon. Quickly, there it is. Look at the baboon up top there. Just like a human being who's trying to pretend he didn't nearly fall out of the tree. Ah, that's wonderful. Now, that is the sentinel, everybody. He is looking out for the rest of the troop to see if there isn't a predator about. And so were he to see a leopard or a lion, he would go, bow, bow, bow. And the others would look up, and they'd know where the threat was and what it wanted. Look at that. How cool is that? That is wonderful. Let's see if we can't get another view of the rest of the troop. How's that hilarious? Ridiculous animals. Right down here we go. They were having a drink around here. There's the Wasserbock. Let's just see if we can't spot the rest of the troop. You know, they're so nervy, these baboons, that I don't want to get too close to them. See if we can't spot them before we drive any further. Bull waterbuck. All right. Let's carry on just around the corner here. I first spotted them. Have you got them? Stop, forward, backwards, sideways. Across the boundary. Oh, look at that. That's wonderful. There they are doing what all families should be doing on a Saturday afternoon, sitting together enjoying the sunset, having a bit of a scratch, feeding on the ticks that have climbed onto their bodies during the day, and possibly eating a little bit of fruit. Isn't that lovely? And as I was saying this morning when we saw them, it's when you see them like this that they look so very human when they're sitting with their feet up, looking around, scratching. Yeah, that's not very polite scratching there, is it? Now, you see those fearsome teeth, of course, that is what makes them very dangerous to something like a leopard. And it's why a leopard will hardly ever go for a baboon, except a young male. Not sort of Hosanna's age, but if you find a 2-year-old, 2.5 to 3-year-old male, they will often take on baboons. I think probably to do with the revenge that they, for the terror they felt as very small cubs. That looks like a young female. Cat, interesting. Yeah, you'd think so. You say, will the sentinel point when he sees danger? What will he do? How will he indicate the direction of where the threat's coming from? No, he won't point. He will just look. He'll just look in that direction, and they will be able to pick up from his look where exactly the threat is coming from. Now, of course, this is a favourite haunt where we are now, right at Twin Dams of Karula, but we know that she's nowhere near here, so she's... they would panic if they saw a leopard. They'd be very cross, of course, and they would probably chase her. So they're not worried about a leopard in this area. There could be Tingana, I suppose. He could be anywhere around here, but the Nkuhumas are nowhere near here. So pretty much, I think these chaps, bar a meeting with Tingana, are going to be very happy just to spend much of the rest of the evening on that termite mound, possibly come down for a bit of a drink, and then they'll climb up into the trees and go to sleep. Annie, a very good question from you, but I don't think it's quite correct. Your assertion is maybe we're seeing these baboons here because we're seeing increasing numbers of baboons because of the impala lambs, so they come into the area to try and catch them. No, because baboons and impala lambs are fairly evenly distributed, and although there are a lot of lambs here, there are lambs everywhere. So I don't know. I don't think that's the reason. I am not sure why they're spending so much more time up here in the north. My guess, Annie, is that because we had more rain up in the north of the Sabi Sand than the south to start with, I suspect things like those white berry bushes, which we've seen them eating, have flushed up here earlier than they have down in the south. And so quite possibly what's happened is that they've moved up into an area where there's just a bit more to eat. There are probably a few more insects around and that sort of thing. But impala lambs will be pretty much universal throughout the place. And I mean, it's unusual that they'll catch an impala lamb. They will try, but it's not common. They look so relaxed and happy there, don't they? There we go. Yeah, they'll go and feed a bit, I suppose. And then they'll find a high tree to roost in, probably on the Mluamati drainage, one of the big scotias or jackalberries. Hello, Carol. You're wondering what baboons do at the night time. Carol, normally they go to a nightclub. They spend a good deal of time drinking heavily at the bar. They really are known for their appalling alcohol habits and then dastardly behaviour afterwards. No, I'm of course being completely facetious. Carol, they go into trees, the tallest trees they can find. So I suppose something like that big jackalberry over there would be ideal. And they'll go up and sit in a tree like that. That's a leadwood, go to the left, there we go. They'll go up into a tree like that and spend the night there, Right, while I tell Jandre the difference between Combritum imberbe and Dirospirus mespiloformes, Jamie has a pile of poo to show you.
That is an interesting way of describing it, but yes, we do in fact have a pile of poo. It was an entirely accurate way of describing it. It is a pile of civet poo, which is actually more correctly known as a civetry, which is basically the equivalent of a civet midden. Now, a civet, for our new viewers, is... how do I describe a civet? It's like a mixture between a cat and a badger. Something like that. But it is not in fact related to either cats. A little bit more closely related to badgers, but not really. It's probably more closely related to mongooses. So it's a sort of a medium-sized animal that eats a variety of different things. And that's why these civetries are always such a fascinating place to be. Because all kinds of things are to be found if you know where to look, or where to dig in this case. And you'll notice that I have a great deal more reticence when it comes to touching civet feces than I might otherwise. So this civet recently has been feeding largely on millipedes. So there's plenty and plenty of millipede exoskeletons. There's also all sorts of things like this. That was actually a relatively large scorpion at one point. Oof. Don't really want to touch it, but I'll pop it. How's that for you? If I pop it there, it was a big scorpion, and it was a big scorpion that was basically swallowed whole. Most of its juices would have been, the civet would have chewed it once or twice after biting off its tail, chewed it once or twice, got the juices out, and then swallowed the entire thing. And of course, exoskeletons are completely indigestible, which is why we're seeing the combination of millipede, which, bear in mind, most animals can't eat. I'd love to know what it is within the civet's biology that allows it to digest that amount of cyanide. It's a lot of cyanide that's contained in all of the millipedes that this civet has eaten. And then we've got something interesting here. And I'm going to try and find another stick because mine just broke and I still don't want to touch this particular pile of things. Unfortunately, we seem to be having a minor problem with the camera, VM tells me, that unfortunately cannot be fixed without us actually doing something to it, which will involve having to, at some point, send you, in fact, not at some point, right now we're going to have to send you over to Byron. We'll catch up with you shortly.
Sorry. So, we're still sitting with the lions, everyone, and... they haven't moved. There's been a bit of stretching and there's been some yawning, but no movement just yet. I'm not sure if they are going to move anytime soon. It's still very, very warm. And as you saw yesterday, we spent some time with lions too, and they didn't move much at all. They're very comfortable and try and stay in the shade and conserve the energy until a little bit later, and then potentially move around and maybe go and, but have a look over there. Got one of the cubs rubbing up against the female. Tricky to see now. That is very, very cute, isn't it? See, the lions are very affectionate, and the reason for that is that it just strengthens the bonds within the pride constantly. They constantly rub up against each other, clean, groom one another, and it strengthens that bond a lot. I think what we might do is we might spend a few more minutes with these lions, maybe another 5 or so minutes, just see if they get up and move. Otherwise, we may move on and see what else we can find. It's nice to see them, but when they are resting like this, there's not a great chance we're going to get too much activity from them.
I wonder if some of our viewers are just enjoying watching sleeping lions and taking the afternoon off a little bit too. Haven't had too many questions. Which is okay. It's nice to just sit and watch and enjoy. Still a very, very clear day. There's not a cloud in the sky. Completely clear. Good afternoon, Parsley, and from my hometown of Johannesburg in Four Ways. Parsley, you'd like to know, are the leopards prone to a mange like lions? They can get it, and I do know of incidents where leopard cubs have died from mange. So yes, they can get it, and there's not much more to say about that, I suppose. Again, I think it's only in times of severe drought and if the animals contract it, especially the cubs are vulnerable to it, and they are usually the ones that can die from it if they get it. But yeah, leopards definitely can get it too. And I do know of incidences where leopards have caught it and died. Or leopard cubs, rather. Cardinal, you're saying these little cubs are really starting to grow up quite quickly and looking like part of the pride already, which is great. And you know, again, you know, we've been monitoring them, and when we do watch them and see when they stand up and move around, they seem to be doing very well. No sign of that white muscle disease that we know they had a while ago. They seem to have recovered from that. And they're all looking good. The whole pride's looking very, very good at the moment, which is great news for us. Very, very happy about that. So maybe it's just a test of survival of the fittest, and those that weren't strong enough to survive it unfortunately didn't make it. But that's, you know, that is nature, and that's nature's way of keeping a balance. Otherwise we'd have too many predators around and possibly no herbivores. So bye bye, enjoy the rest of your afternoon, bye. Liz, now you are one of the viewers that do try and study the markings and try and identify each lioness. And when they are still like this and they are lying down, it is a bit easier to have a good look at markings and try and see if you can identify the lionesses and that. Now, we actually, when I was guiding at a lodge permanently, we tried to form a identification kit for lions, so we could get an idea of which females and which prides were around and what was going on. But I must admit, we found it very, very difficult. And I'm a little hesitant just to say we recognize a lioness or a male lion. You know, if there are distinct markings, which there are if you study them closely. But at times, some of the lionesses can be difficult. And I know, I remember, we did try. We had photographs, we had ID kits, and we tried, and then there'd always be a debate between the ranging team which lions were where. So it's just always wonderful to see a pride of lions or to see a leopard, but it is still nice. I know for a lot of us who view these animals regularly, it is nice to know which ones we are seeing and where they're moving. I'm going to leave these lions now. They're not going to move anywhere. Doesn't look like anytime soon. Let's see what else we can find. But while I do that, let's quickly head back to Jamie on the bushwalk.
I am still with my civetree because I actually hadn't finished talking about it before we had a minor issue with the camera. So let us finish off where we were. So if you cast your minds back to about, I don't know, probably about 7 minutes ago, you will remember we were chatting a little bit about the exoskeletons and the fact that it is remarkable that civets will be able to digest and to metabolize the cyanide contained within millipedes. But what's also remarkable is the number of these beetles that are in this particular civetry, and they're actually all over. The more I sit and I look, the more I can see the sort of the main mass of the civetry heaving as these beetles dig below the surface of the dung, or of the feces to be more exact. We've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 4. There was a fifth somewhere here, but at some point while I wasn't watching, he's dug his way in here. They're fascinating to watch, and they are a species of dung beetle, apparently. So Aubrey tells me they're a species of dung beetle, and obviously one that is, which makes sense, because they're sitting in a pile of feces. So they're a species of dung beetle that obviously is adapted to deal with the byproducts of civet digestion. There's another one. I'll cover him up in a moment. That must have been where the fifth one went. Digging slowly but surely down into the pile of dung. And of course, not all dung beetles roll balls of dung. So this particular one must have been, or this particular species must obviously be adapted to dig right down underneath this civetry, which probably is quite deep. Probably the debris extends quite deep, because a civet will come by this spot each and every single night and deposit his feces. Sorry, buddy, I'll cover you up again. There you go. I uncovered you. There you go. Now you're nice and protected. They seem to be, the five of them were actually together earlier, and it looked as though some of them were mating with each other. So it does seem as though we've got a nice mixture of males and females here, but I'm not 100% sure. I really am not 100% sure about the life cycle of this particular beetle. I can just say that they are, in fact, beetles. And the other interesting thing about this civet dung, feces, is that it contains grass as well, very badly digested grass. And perhaps the civet wasn't feeling particularly healthy, or perhaps it just adds a necessary part of their diet. Very interesting. So civets are omnivorous. And James Robertson, you mentioned that perhaps it is, or that you had read somewhere that it was the fruits that they eat that can neutralize the cyanide within the millipedes. And that's very interesting. What confuses me about that, I mean, I'm more than willing to take your word for it, but what confuses me about that particular theory is that there aren't actually any fruits at the moment, except maybe white berry bushes, but I've never really seen a civet eat a white berry bush. Their favorite, you'll often find in fresh civet scats, you'll often find old jackalberry seeds, like these. These are jackalberry seeds. But these are old. These are very, very old. The jackalberries have actually stopped fruiting now. I haven't seen any fruiting jackalberries. I've never seen a civet eat a marula fruit. I have seen them eat guari berries and raisin bushes. It's interesting because they don't have access to fruit all year round. Certainly they don't have access to millipedes all year round. That's purely a summer delight. But they don't have berries all the way, or fruit all the way, all the year round. So I'm curious to know exactly what it is within. Perhaps they store something from the fruits that help them to metabolize the cyanide. I don't know, but I'm curious to actually find out. I've seen, as I mentioned this morning, I've seen wild dogs eat them as well. They love to chew them. There's a whole heap of information gathered sort of together in this one little civetry. I don't know why civets get their own name, why it isn't just called a midden. Impala don't get their own name, it's called a midden. Rhino get called a midden.
Hyena's got their
own. Oh yes, that's true. A hyena has a latrine. Valid point from them. A hyena has a latrine. And here, I know I said I wasn't going to touch it, but I can't help it because I can't pick that up. It's too delicate. Wait, let me actually do this. Oh, goodness. I feel like this could end badly for me. That is the end of a scorpion sting. Maybe even the scorpion that we saw the exoskeleton of earlier. How cool is that? That incredibly sharp point. And then look at that, the bristles all over the tip of the tail. Obviously for helping it to feel and to guide the tail, particularly when using it for hunting and for stinging. And speaking from experience, that tail is whip fast. It is very, very fast. And this would have been quite sore. This looks like it was either, it could have been a Pithecanthropus, or it could have been a very terrifying, I think it's probably a Pithecanthropus, so it's not a hugely painful one. Or it could have been a, what are they called? Europlectes. Probably not a Parabuthus. Intimidating, isn't it? Okay, well, that can go back to the dung beetles to use as their debris. I think we've dissected the civetry enough. I once was desperately searching for a way to describe the smell of this particular civetry and what civetries smell like. Now, VM's very good at describing scents, and so is James. And James told me that it smells like goat. And that's exactly what it smells like. A civetry, particularly a fresh civetry, smells like goat. I don't see any complete pieces of civet feces, so I can't actually show you what those look like. They are exceptionally large for the size of the animal, but they don't appear to be any. So I think we'll leave our civetry dung beetles to their business and start slowly but surely heading for home. We'll have to navigate around Queen Karula, who's not too far away from us as we speak. Well, up we get. Okay, there, VM. Do you want me to grab that battery? You got it. Okay. Cool. Whew, and again, the world did a little spin. Well, we're just trundling along down Philemon's cut line, past the old hyena den. Old and empty hyena den. It's very sad. I do wish they would come back and rejoin us once again. It would be very nice if they would do so. Liz, absolutely, it's possible that a civet might have the knowledge of plants to counteract the effects of the cyanide, much the way an elephant has an understanding of what plants it can use for toothache, for example, or whatever stomach ailments it happens to have. The same with many animals in the Torchwoods and the Tambuertes and various sort of different medicinal plants that the animals know about. So yes, it is totally possible that the civet is aware of some sort of plant that would actually help it to break down and deal with the presence of so much cyanide in its diet. I don't know. I don't know whether James or Byron have any greater insight into how the biology of a civet works. I'd be very curious to know. I might have to go and try and find out. And it's not like it's the only animal, but it is the animal that really their diet is very much dependent upon a diet of millipedes, particularly in summer. There's a civet that lives somewhere not too far away from here in the Philemon's Dip drainage line. So that probably is his or her civetry. And both of them will contribute to civetries. They also mark their territory by anal pasting, which puts them really into the group of mongoose, what are those things called? Genets. Not all together in the same family, but related in the sort of the same super order, or same order. That's not true, sorry. No, it is, it's the same order. Right, well, as we slowly but surely trundle on home through Philemon's Dip, it is time for us to say our goodbyes and our thank yous. So a big thank you to Aubrey and to VM. Aubrey for his security detail and for helping us find things, and to VM for his wonderful camera work. And a big thank you to all of you for joining us. I will catch you on the Sunrise Safari tomorrow morning. Until then, bye-bye everybody. I hope you have a fantastic rest of the Sunset Safari.
Ta-da! Did you like the little ident, everybody? That's the first time I've ever been linked to from the ident. I'm quite like it. especially when Jamie says goodbye and we have soothing music, and then me. Chandra is looking shocked. Right, our plan is now to head towards Beefles Hook Dangween and see if we can't find anything there. Perhaps the elephants that eluded Baron have decided to come along this way. I have suggested that one of us goes back to the leopards at some stage today, and Baron, of course, has not seen the leopards today, so I feel it is only fair that should he wish to go, then he should go. Because we, of course, have spent all our time with the leopard and some baboons. Let's see what else we can see up here. What have you seen?
Stone.
A stone. There's a tiny, tiny little thing. I think it might be a lamb. It is, it's a young duiker. And like all duikers, it's running away at great speed. Sigh and wheeze, sigh and wheeze. Ooh. There is a very large pig. Nice timing there, Jean-Dre, well done. It's still very hot, you know, everybody. It seems to have got hotter almost. And that pig agrees with me because he's been sitting in some mud. So he's very comfortable. He goes, we'll try and... Yeah, let's go a little... Oh, no, you've still got him there. Let's just watch him move. There we go. All right, let's carry on. Let's go up the way here. Now, it always amazes me when I look at a pig like that. It's not the biggest pig I've ever seen, but it's not a tiny pig either. That a pig like that can weigh as much as a newborn elephant. Oh, and there's another pig in the background. A plethora of pigs. Now, he's turned his backside like that to us because he knows that he's quite fast, and should he wish to run away, that is the end that he wishes to sacrifice before he wishes to sacrifice the front end. I always think it must be such a terrifying life as a pig. Now, watch Andre do what's called a focus pull. Do it, Andre. Oh, beautiful. I wonder if that's his wife. No, I think it's his companion. Gorgeous. Right, well, he's clearly sick and tired of us. Let's carry on. What else we can find. It's very nice having a little bit of breeze blowing on my face. What do you think, Jandre? Pleasant, isn't it? Oh, there was a nice cuckoo flying there. Panis, you... You're wondering about smell, something very close to my own heart, or my nose, ha ha ha. You're wondering which animal smells the worst out here. I think that, what animal smells the worst out here? I think you'll probably find that a hyena, if it gets close to you, is probably the worst, most evil smelling thing. Wild dogs smell bad. I mean, they smell like wet dog. There's a steenbok that is now frightened because I made a noise by hitting a bush. Can you see it there? Andre, there it is, young male, very nice. Obviously running away, why wouldn't he? So, Panis, I would say a hyena is probably the most smelly thing out here, other than a wild dog, but wild dogs I like too much to cast aspersions on their scent. And I believe that perhaps the stalking predators like lion and leopard I certainly can't pick up a smell from them. And, of course, our human noses are pathetic in comparison with the animals out here. But I don't pick up a smell from them, so I don't think that they smell particularly strong. And little Steenbok decided to lie down. There, we can still see you, Channa. There we go. There we go. And he's a little bit nervous, obviously. But interestingly, the thing that we know smells the least are the young calves of animals that don't live in thick bush and have to move down to water. In other words, things like sable and roan, they, which are antelope we don't get here anymore, but they live in long grasslands away from water, so they have to go down to drink, which means they have to leave their youngsters. And they're able to do that because their youngsters are born with almost no scent at all. And so where a predator, that predator would actually have to stand on them in order to find them. And obviously they don't do that in the long grass away from the water. And so that's why they don't smell at all. That's the young of roan and sable, which are two antelope we don't get here. Two of the most beautiful antelope. I shall show you a picture just in case you are a new viewer. And Cecilia, you're wondering how little a newborn Steenbok is. I've never seen a newborn Steenbok, but I mean, judging by its size, proportions, it must be about that big. Isn't that tiny? Right, let me find you the roan and the sable quickly. I should, of course, just be able to turn to them because I'm so skillful, but unfortunately I cannot. And they are two of the most beautiful antelope. They're known from a family called the Hippotragi, which basically means the horse-like antelope. There they are. There they are. Hippotragini. That is the roan on the top and the sable at the bottom. Magnificent creatures. I'm not sure why, I suppose it's slightly horse-like without the horns. Gorgeous. Right, on we go. Beefeldhoek Dam, our next stop. Byron is apparently going to head towards the leopards, so that's very nice. Not sure where young Hosanna is. I'm a little bit worried about him, but I'm sure he's fine. Nice to have our leopards all in one place, I find. Excuse me. Now there's a bataleer's nest up around here, and the bataleer's nest that we have up around here is very kind of famous because we see it all the time, and I wonder when they're going to sort of bring forth another chick, because they've had a juvenile living around here with them. Now he's not quite an adult plumage yet, and he's been around here since I've been here, and I'm sure he must be about time that he went off on his own. The nest is somewhere up here, but I don't see either of the bataleer. Meow. Okay, let's carry on. And try and find something at the waterhole, perhaps an elephant. Elephants have dispersed a huge distance now. Oh, and Debbie, you know, of course, that I've been hoping to find some weavers. You're asking if any of them have been building their nests around the waterholes, and I must confess to you that I haven't seen any weavers. Taylor saw one or two, I think lesser masked weaver, they're now called village weavers, not lesser masked. They used to be called spotted-backed weavers. They're now called spotted-backed weavers, or village weavers. And she's seen them building one or two nests, but I really haven't seen anything. And the tree that they used to build in that hung neatly over the water treehouse dam has unfortunately come away from its moorings as a result of the excavations that took place there. So they're not doing it there. But maybe at Beefeldhoek Dam, I haven't seen any though, which is a bit sad because I love the sound of weavers. They're swizzling calls. I saw one the other day. He was swizzling away, but he wasn't building any nests. Last year, of course, as many of you will know, we had almost no weaver activity at all on account of the fact that there was so little water. So little rain. Right, we're now under the Cheetah Cut Line, and which is the far eastern boundary of our traversing area. And if you look up the road, what you can see is that we have got very golden light now, where the sun has set sufficiently for us to start enjoying the light. There's a cool breeze starting to blow. There's a baby impala over there. I'm sure it's going to hide behind a tree so we can't see it. That's difficult not for it to hide behind a tree in that sort of area. You see it there, Gendry. There we are. Mum and little baby. That's brand new. That is very, very new indeed. And that's why, of course, they're on their own. It just takes about half an hour or so for the youngster to stand up and move and be quick enough for her to find the herd again. A very, very vulnerable time for them right now. That is a completely defenseless animal. See, it can hardly stand. Isn't that cute? Karula nowhere near us, so she's safe from Karula. Poor impalas. I do feel sorry for them. Everything likes to eat them. And Jerry reckons this might be one of the youngest ones we've seen this season. I mean, it can hardly remain upright. There's a little bit of the umbilicus there. I could see that's the remnants of the umbilical cord. Very sweet. Look at the nose looking through the bushes there. That's really cool. Until it doesn't do it anymore, of course. It's turning into a beautiful afternoon. Right, let's carry on from here. We'll leave the little baby tiny impala. Oh, no we won't. There's the juvenile battalier of which I spoke. Do you see it, Gendry? And there it is. He's struggling to leave home, this poor fellow. Who can blame him? He's a millennial. He's a millennial battalier. It's a very impressive haircut he's got. As the gentle breeze blows up his crest. So for those of you who don't know, of course, a battalier is normally a magnificent bird of black and white and with a bright red face and red legs. But when they're young, they're not quite as good looking as when they're adults. And that one probably, I would say, in his sort of fourth year. So he's about a four-year-old bird. They're only fully grown or fully in adult plumage in their seventh years. So he's got some way to go before he's fully adult. He might be a little bit older than that. You can see that in that picture that his tail is almost completely gone. And the adults, of course, have no tail at all. And that just helps them to fly at low level without any drag and minimum effort. Even preening his bottom leg feathers, that's interesting. It's obviously very difficult to keep feathers in good order because once they're mature, the blood vessels die inside them. And so they don't really have any feeling and there's no kind of nervous system feeding them. And so they have to manually fix every single feather on their bodies. Yeah, completely unlike our sort of hairs, which live and rejuvenate themselves. Hello, Kimber. You're loving the bird sightings at the moment. I'm also loving the bird sightings, Kimber. I think they're great fun. Summer, of course, is the best time to be looking at birds. It's an excellent, excellent time to be enjoying the avifauna of the Greater Kruger National Park. On we go. Spider-hunting wasp nearly took me out. And the other thing we're going to look out for, of course, Jean-André, as we head towards December is?
Santa.
Not Santa, no.
Reindeer.
Reindeer, no, not reindeer. Try once more. I'll give you a clue. Not elves, no, no. It begins with Miss, but it's not Mrs. Claus, no. Mistletoe, very good. And of course, mistletoe grows in these marula trees around here. We shall try and find some. And I shall make sure that I am not underneath it at the same time as Jean-André. Well, that will frighten me deeply. In fact, I'm getting a shudder. Hello, Samantha. You're wondering about any local culture or local holidays around this time of the year, perhaps, or at other times of the year. We have a number, but most of them are kind of... Jean-André is now pouring water in his eye. What is wrong with you, man?
Something flew
into his eye. In fact, it's swollen up quite nastily. Oh, well, we might have to take him home. Never mind him for now. Samantha, there are no sort of very traditional holidays that we have out here. Many national holidays, but they're much more recent, sort of born of the last 60 years or so. In fact, most of them in the last 25 years or so, since the advent of democracy here. There are no real kind of cultural holidays, I don't think. I mean, there are a couple of localized ones, absolutely. Sort of king's birthdays and that sort of thing, but not much otherwise, no. So, for example, in KwaZulu, which is the east coast of South Africa, the northeast coast of South Africa, they may well celebrate the king's birthday, but it wouldn't be sort of a national holiday, but it might be a localized holiday for people. Right, we're heading towards my favorite mistletoe spot, so we're just going to avoid it. Don't want to be under there with Jean-André. How's your eye, Jean-André? Is it okay? Good. That's a relief. I want to stop and have to administer first aid to Jean-André. Not exactly. Now, I'm going to try and get us into a position where we can watch the sun go down. It's starting to look rather pretty. I haven't seen a zebra since I've returned, I don't think. And that is because they have all dispersed off to other areas as the grass has started to flush. It's quite a nice tree up here. But we can try and look at the sunset through. Here we go. Now we're not parked underneath it, but there is an enormous example of mistletoe up in this tree here. You see in the top left-hand corner there, that's it. Now with any luck, it'll start to flower fairly soon. There we can see the beginnings of the flowers. That's it. And this one I think is called lighted matches, because the flowers look like Jean-André. Yes, that's correct. Lighted matches. That's very good. Well done. Excellent. Now, that is a parasite on the tree. It will eventually kill off that particular piece of the tree. And then the tree will have to sacrifice that bough. It will fall off. And no doubt the mistletoe will take up root somewhere else. Isn't that nice? Now, what we'll do is just give it a very wide berth, of course. Right. Alrighty, here we go. Chandra is pulling horrible faces at me, everyone. It's not something you want to see. Don't worry, I'll put up with it for your sake. Ah, that's what I wanted to do. Sunset, not under the mistletoe, no genre. Next to that gorgeous tree there. Huh? There we go. Ah, too much beautiful, eh? Very lovely. Mountains in the background. I, of course, have looked directly at that sun, so I can see nothing else at all. Isn't that pretty? Chandra, tell me it's pretty. What do you mean, hmm? It's gorgeous. There we go. Ah, dream state. Super zoom the sun. It is a bit too hot. Alrighty, let's carry on. We're nearly at Biffleshook Dam. We'll watch the rest of it from there. That's very slick handling of the ND filter there, Jean-Ré. I'm going to drive a little bit quicker, just so that we do have a little bit of time and light at the water. In case there's some elephants having their sundowners there. Yeah, Debbie, I think you're probably right in Vancouver there. You say perhaps we need an entirely normal rainy season for the weavers to come back. Look, the weavers are around. I just think still some of the males haven't achieved their adult plumage. What have you seen, Jandre? Lion tracks crossing out. Thank you very much. Very helpful. So, Debbie, I think maybe you're right. The weavers are around. They're just kind of nondescript and drab and brown. They haven't achieved that gorgeous golden yellow plumage that they get in the summertime. And that's probably, you're right, because there isn't sufficient to eat just yet for them. And I'll just nip around the corner here to the dam. There's something else I wanted to say, but I've forgotten what it was. Ah, sunset in summer, Jean-Dre, isn't it lovely? Marvellous. Not much else going on other than the sunset. Byron, in case you're worried, everybody, is a little bit lost, but he is on his way to the leopard, so he'll be there soon. That's why you're stuck with me waffling away. We just need to give him a bit of time to find it. And then you will be back with Karula and Oshongile. Unless she's moved off, of course. We might get another sunset view here. Sorry, Diane, I missed your question there. Geraldine, you'll have to go again with it. Oh, does all mistletoe grow as parasites? I think it does, Diane. As far as I'm aware, all mistletoe does indeed grow as parasites on other trees, all the species throughout the world. I'm not sure it ever kills a tree, but certainly out here, and it doesn't kill the trees, but it does chop off pieces of them. Eventually, and I think it's the tree actually sacrificing. Many trees will do that, and if you look at brown ivories quite often, what else? Brown ivories and jackalberries, they will sometimes, in really adverse conditions, Scotias do it, the weeping boobean, they will often, after a drought, for example, sacrifice three or four of the biggest limbs, of the biggest branches, and they will just die off and eventually fall off the tree. It doesn't make a huge difference to the tree, of course. It's not quite as big and magnificent as it once was, but they do drop off their branches in order kind of to save themselves. Byron apparently is... Oh, sorry, yes. Byron is with the leopards. Let's go and find out how they are immediately.
So we decided to give up on the lions who were resting, so we decided to come and have a look at the resting leopards. It's so great to see Karula and one of her cubs again. I haven't seen them for a while, so it's nice to get to and hopefully spend some time. And maybe with it cooling down, we might get a bit of activity and they might move around. So let's see. It could be really, really nice and lovely cool drainage line that they have found themselves in. I can't see where the kill is at the moment. I think it's behind us somewhere, the remains of the kill. I can see they're quite hot. I'm just resting the drainage line. This is still the little female, Shungile. I always struggle with the pronunciation and it's names that you don't hear very often. I can't remember, Brian, is it? Shungile. And Hosana, I don't know where he is, he's wandering off around somewhere. A young male, as young males do, I suppose. It's always just so incredible to sit and watch leopards like this. It is relaxing again. I mean, it just shows you that generally the cat behavior when it is hot, they do prefer resting and lying down in drainage lines like this. I'm not sure where they were lying when James saw them, if they were out in the open or if they were deeper in. But still just resting in this area. There's no need to move, I suppose. They've got food nearby and... it's cooler here than anywhere else. Kathy, so you wanted to know if these leopard cubs will move or become independent on their own, or does the mother have to push them away? So, Kathy, usually what happens is once they get, and the average is about a year and a half, so 18 months, once these little cubs get to about that age, the female actually forces them out. She'll start hissing and growling at them, and then they quickly get the idea that they have to move off and find their own little territory. But what happens is the females, so Karula would most likely give up a portion of her territory for the young female, and the young male, he will have to move off and find, he'll be nomadic for a while, but he'll have to go and find his own territory where there's no big dominant male that will push him out. His father might, and again, we think his father is Tingana, he might tolerate the young male being around for a while until he gets to a certain age, and then possibly chase him out and cause him to go and find his own territory. I have seen young male leopards 2-3 years old, 4 years old, with their father still in the same area, and occasionally the two of them meeting. So it can happen, but generally speaking, they do get pushed out and they have to go and find their own territory. But the females, they'll give up a portion of the territory for the young females. And then she can extend it in the opposite direction away from where her mother's territory is. sure. I always feel like these cars bake us a little bit, I think. We gently slow cook in here. That panting again, just to try and stay cool. And I wonder if that young male will meet up with these two later. A good possibility, a good chance. Bobby, you want to know, how does the female know when to stop taking care of the cub? So, I think it's just instinct, Bobby. I think the females, now again, you know, I think she knows, she realizes when they get to a certain age that they're now old enough and probably mature enough to go on their own, and she perhaps has taught them how to hunt well enough and they need to fend for themselves. But I've seen quite a range in that age where they get pushed out. I've seen young cubs as young as a year old get pushed out and fend for themselves and survive. And I've seen young male cubs up to 2 years old, just, you know, about 2 years old, just over 2 years, staying with the female, hanging around, and when she makes a kill, that big young male, because at that age they're already quite big, will come through and try and steal the kill from her, but they'll follow the mother and stay with her. So I've seen quite a range, but generally it's instinct. The female knows these cubs are probably successful enough or able to be successful on their own. She's taught them how to hunt. And we saw it the other day. Brent was very fortunate to see the young cubs chasing a squirrel. And that's all a learning process for them, learning how to hunt, learning how to stalk, learning to use their agility and their speed to catch something. And when they get a little bit older, the female might even possibly take them into an area where she could leave them to try and hunt for themselves, and they'll start working their way up, maybe smaller antelope. These impala lambs at the moment are actually a good way for her to teach the young cubs. Once they get to that stage, she'll probably then decide that it's enough, they need to move off on their own, and she can continue doing what leopards do, patrolling her territory and potentially mate again. I do think this female might have the chance to mate again in another litter, judging by her age. Because how old she's now? 10, I think, almost 11 years old. She's about 10 years old, I think, if I remember correctly. I stand to correction. I think she was born in 2006. Sorry, she was born in 2004, so 12 years old. 12 years old, that's it. So yeah, so I do think she's got a perhaps another litter left that she might be able to raise. She's been such a successful leopard, I wouldn't be surprised if she didn't have another litter. No, I wouldn't be surprised if she did have another litter, rather. How cute is that little female? Very, very beautiful. It was very kind of James to let us come back into this area while he was in search for something else. So we get to spend a little time with the leopards. I haven't actually sat with leopards for a while, so it's nice to get back, view some leopards and spend some time with them and see what they get up to. I have been very, very fortunate that in my guiding career, I've worked in areas where leopard viewing is incredible, I've seen a lot of leopard behavior and seen a lot of leopards, from cubs to adults to mating leopards fighting, just about everything, which has been great because I've learned so much just from viewing them rather than actually reading up in a book, because some of the stuff that I've seen, some of the behavior I've seen, I've never read. So it is interesting to see how wild animals adapt and change their behavior from what experts think they know. I think it does change out here daily, which is important. We need to remember that, because they're wild animals. There's never a guarantee. You can never predict what they're going to do. I mean, by the amount of, well, the years I've spent viewing leopard, I've got an idea of what I think they might do, but it's never a guarantee. Never, ever. James, interesting question about the males. You want to know if the males, or if I know of a male that's stayed nomadic and has been unable to establish a territory for itself. I'm just trying to think now, James. Sure, not that I can think of. All the young male leopards that I remember all managed to set up a small territory of sorts. And I think all that would happen is if there was a lot of dominant male leopards around, then those territories that they set up might just be a lot smaller. But I do think they do end up staying in an area at some point. But then once they get old and they get pushed out, then they become nomadic again if there's too much competition. Then yes, they will indeed just move through areas and try to stay away from dominant males. They won't scent mark as much or at all, and then try to keep a low profile, just hunt and feed and survive, and that's it, and just try to stay out of the way of the dominant male. So it can happen, it can happen. Oh, there we go. Karula is up. She might just change positions. Let's see what she does. Little just relieving herself there of Impala. And it's interesting how big cats will get up. They'll walk away from where they're lying down, and then they'll drop their dung or their scat. And often when they get up after resting for long periods of time, and then they, now we'll see, she could potentially just change her position and go lie down somewhere else again. It is still warm. Oh, look, little cub is doing the same now. If she walks back this way. There we go. And I'm curious as to what she's going to do. She may head back towards a kill, although I'm not sure where it is. No. There we go. Just change positions, lie down in some cool sand again. Oh, look, here comes a little Shungile just in front of the vehicle. Not far from us. So I swapped with James basically. I'm here with the leopards and he has gone to the Nkuhumas. Let's see what they're up to.
Right, everybody, we're here with the lion pride in the hopes that, well, rather like I was hoping that leopards might do, they'd get up and do something, and they do indeed seem to have got up and are doing something. But what we did notice, of the three in the little pile over there, is that the one closest to us has got a rather nasty wound underneath her left elbow. Isn't that cute? It is rather marvellous, I must say. So sweet. So this is what they, of course, do, lions. They start to get going as the sun goes down. They stretch, they lie down, they stretch, they do a bit of bonding, then they lie down again, and then eventually they get moving. Now, I haven't seen this pride since I went away, and when I went away, they were in, seemed to be in dire chance, or there seemed to be a chance of them being wiped out completely by that white muscle disease. And while that cub doesn't look great, I must say, he's certainly walking easily. There's not a problem there. And now he's relieving himself. Chandra, give the man some privacy. There's one lying there on its back having a play. That's much more entertaining. Right a bit.
Behind the bush.
Oh, is it behind the bush for you? I'm so sorry. That's not behind the bush, Chandra.
There's one rolling behind the bush.
Very cute. They're starting to move already. Now, it's quite early for them to be moving, but they are hungry. You can, oh, there's that gash. Nasty gash. Look at that. That can... Oof, I wonder what did that. Could have been a claw. Easily have been a tooth mark, I suppose. Maybe from a male. And apparently it was seen 4 or 5 days ago and it was a lot worse. It is a lot worse now. Yeah, it's obviously bugging her. Look how they've got that funny little teenager look about them now. I don't know if you can see that over there, everybody. Lioness now sharpening her claws. Let me move very slightly forward. And what would have been such a lovely picture if I'd been parked correctly. They're heading up sort of towards the Biffles or cut line. Sorry. Go. Oh. Not sure what happened there. Now that one's really got a gangly kind of teenager look about it now, or pre-teen look. And clearly unable to scratch without using its tongue at the same time. And look how they mangled their ears are. That's from the mange that they recovered from. In the background, of course, you can hear the pearl-spotted owl. Now, best of all, Jean-Henri, look at that little cub there with the floppy ear. Taylor's very favourite lion. I think many of our favourite lion. Isn't she sweet? I'm so glad she survived. The Egyptian geese flying overhead. And the lion's just sort of, the lioness is growling a little, ho, 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 telling the cubs that it's time to get up and get going. And the cubs won't hunt at this stage, but they'll start to be a little bit closer by than they were before. They might follow a bit and then they'll stay. Then they'll find a hidey hole and stay in it. That's amber eyes, I think. Now again, her mating situation has not lasted long. It's lasted far shorter, I think, than it should have. So whether she's actually managed to conceive a youngster or not, I'm not sure. all been doing a little bit of marking on that tree, smelling it, rubbing, leaving their claw marks. There is an element of territoriality about that. I would move forward, everyone, but I'm afraid I've parked us right on a stump, so I can't. Jackie, you reckon that their claw sharpening is a good sign for some hunting activity? Well, it might be. The lying down isn't such a great sign for some hunting activity. What isn't such a good sign, Jackie, is that they're heading due north towards Biffle's Hook, which is not great. There are the little cubs. And we'll just wait for them, I think, to see if they get up and move. Good little floppy ear. They do look not quite the same as they did before the mange outbreak, do they? Not quite as pristine, but that is the life of a lion. And these little chaps have really made it through some really harrowing times. And they'll start to move, I think, when they cannot see the lionesses anymore. There's one lioness still sitting next to us. I'm just going to call this in on the radio quickly in case anyone wants to come and see. If I can find the correct radio, I've about 75 here with me. There it is. Stations in Kahuma Pride is now mobile in a north-easterly direction towards Biffle's Hook cut line. The youngsters are still on Mbubu Road. The lionesses have moved northeast towards the cut line. That's very sweet, isn't it? Now, I'm struggling to tell the difference between them, the cubs, anymore. Sorry about that movement. And, of course, when they are a year old or a little bit older than that, it'll be impossible to tell the difference. If they all lay next to each other, we could tell who was younger and who was older. I'm just going to tell you what's happening on the left. We're not going to try and show it with the camera. But the lioness has now started to move off, and you can see they've sat up to look. There we go. There you can see the different sizes. Oh, so cute. Yeah, Asha, I share your sentiments completely. You say that you've been gone for 3 weeks and you can't believe how big they've gotten. You're so relieved that they are looking so well. Well, I am too. I think they do look great, and they're all now marking on that same tree. Let me just get us into a decent position for that, finally, as they move off. Okay. All right, we're going to try and follow them. I'm going to try and follow them sort of parallel with the road. Now, I think they've moved off the road because they don't want to be in an obvious area. They're moving off sort of in that direction there, and I think they're going to pop out onto the cut line. So while we see if we can find them the other side, and while the light is fading, let's have one last look, I think, at those leopards with Byron, and we'll hopefully catch up with these lions on the other side here.
So Karula's just moved off, but Shungile is still right in front of us, so I'm not going to move at all. Karula's just moved down the drainage line, up the drainage line. I wonder if the little one will follow her mother. I'm sure curiosity is going to get the better of her, and she'll potentially stand up and follow. Oh, hang on, there we go, just as I say that. See, she's watching her mother intently. I can't see where the female is. She's moved a little bit, or basically behind some trees now, so I can't see her at all. Oh, look at those beautiful eyes. Isn't that wonderful? I can hear Karula. I can hear some branches moving. I wonder if there isn't a tree that you potentially try to take that kill up, but unfortunately just can't move at the moment because the little cub is in front of us, which is okay. It's not the end of the world. We'll just be patient and see. This little one is not moving at all. I'm going to try to see if I can't see where. But it is a bit dark. No, I really can't see anything from here at all. If I don't just quickly check. No, there's some trees in front of me. So there's absolutely no way of. Sorry, I keep sticking my cap in the way. So she's moved a little bit now, but it's still, because she's still young, I don't want to really move too much closer to them and disturb the little one. She's still a little bit nervous of the vehicle, so I think if we were moving without the mother close by. So I'm not going to bother them. Hang on, let's just see quickly where she goes. If she moves up the drainage line. All right, she's moving up. I'm going to try reposition. Let's quickly head back to James. I think the Unkahumas are out in the open on the road.
Right, well, we're back on the cubs and they are moving now due north. They came back out sort of onto the road and I'll move towards them now. And we'll just see what they're doing. Of course, we can't really put lights on the little cubs, so I'm going to be a little bit careful about getting too close to them. We'll just put a little bit of sort of light wash on them. That'll be okay, especially if they're with the adults, but we're not going to put a huge amount of light on them. We've just got a few minutes left. And you see the little ones just hanging back from the adults there. Now these lions are definitely on the hunt. It's interesting, you know, I haven't seen the little ones move with the pride while they're hunting yet. And so what's happening is I think that they'll move with the pride for a while, and then if the hunt gets very serious, they'll be told to lie down and shut up. And we often ask, how is that possible? We're not really sure. It's a look or it's a different kind of a growl or something like that. But the cubs will just sort of stop moving. That's immediately why they're staying behind and they're not moving with the lionesses up at the front. Not easy to find yourself some dinner out here, I want to tell you. I mean, they've had a hard day of sleeping. Now they must go and find dinner, kill it, risk injury. Yeah, I'm not going to move until these chaps have kind of caught up with the others. The adults up front seem to have stopped though. And I wonder if they haven't spotted something. One of them's gone off to the right. There might be something in there. Go on. I get terrified now every time I see a cub lying down and not moving with the rest of the pride. I assume it must have some kind of dread disease. But I think this one's okay, I'm sure. We've seen them moving, they're fine. Now the adults up front moving very stealthily now into the bush. Completely silently, and I'm afraid I can't follow them while the cubs are here. So we'll just have to wait and see what plays out. We might hear a sudden rush. The cubs might just get up and move. The cicadas are calling, very quiet changing of the guard tonight. Very little in the way of robins making their final calls. One or two franklins and things, but not a great deal. Let's just see what happens here. So we'll sit here. I mean, you can obviously see all of the cubs on the ground there. The young, or the lionesses, have headed off that way. And I'm afraid I can't really move right now. I've got to wait for them. I'll turn the lights off and just move slightly forward. Just turn the light on a little bit there, and you can look at that one moving. And that one, I mean, it is walking a little bit sort of stiffly, and that's okay. Breeze, you're wondering why it is that lions and leopards have got black around their mouths. Well, Breeze, the answer is that that's just kind of the color of their skin. They've got gray skin, and around the mouth it gets very black. And I mean, it's the same as a dog, really, a dog or a cat. That's the color of their skin quite often around the mouth there. I'm trying to find a very low light setting that's a bit bright. That's all right. It's all right for now. We'll just have a quick look there. And then I'm afraid we are going to have to turn off and leave them. I'm afraid this is too bright for them when they're on their own, so I'm going to turn off. I know that's not the best picture in the world, and we're going to bid the Nkuhuma pride farewell and hope that they do very well in catching something delicious to eat this evening. So just to reiterate to those of you who are perhaps new viewers, the cubs have now been left on their own by the lionesses. The lionesses have moved through there. They're clearly on the hunt, and so with so little time left, I'm not going to try and find another route around towards the lionesses, and I'm not going to shine a light on the cubs because they are alone. And we do know that spotlights and lights and that sort of thing can, just maybe slightly blind them in the same way that it does us, but also lights can attract things like hyenas. And of course, these cubs have had to pull through some really nasty times of late, and so we're just going to let them be. Good, well, it's been a rather productive day. Right, everybody, that's going to be it from John, Dree and I today. It's been lovely having you on safari. Gorgeous afternoon we've had, quite hot. Tomorrow will be slightly cooler at 0500 when we see you then. So until then, stay safe and happy, and we will see you in the morning.
And look what I've found, or Brian has found. It flew and landed on Brian. Brian passed it on to me. A beautiful little click beetle, I believe. And they do make a clicking sound. I haven't heard it before. Oh, wait, it might fly. Is it going to fly? Do you want to fly? No, it's staying with us. It is beautiful though, really, really beautiful bug. All right, where do you want to go now? Sorry, I'm going to twist my arm off. I'm just going to try flick it off so that it may go back to nature. Just actually, here we go. Well, what a wonderful afternoon. Very, very warm afternoon, and a nice way to finish. I hope you've all enjoyed it with us. Thank you very much to Jamie and Viam on Bushwalk, and Jandre and James on the other vehicle, and then obviously the ladies in the FC. Thank you very much to Jerry and to Rebecca. It was a lovely afternoon with leopards and lions. Thank you for all your questions. It's always great to having all the viewers. Thank you very much to Brian and the Thumb. It was a lovely afternoon. We will see you all tomorrow morning on our sunrise safari. Goodbye, good night. Have a wonderful day wherever you are. Bye, everyone.